About 10 minutes late. I'd like to welcome you all to the regular meeting of the Enfield Town Council. Today is Tuesday, February 18th, 2014. I'd ask everyone in the audience to please stand for a prayer led by Councilman Edward Denny, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
Lord, as we undertake to recognize the efforts of this town council, we ask of you, Lord, that special sense of duty, responsibility be brought to the hearts and minds of all of us present, and may you guide our words and actions now and in the future. Amen.
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 Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Ed, and may we have roll call, please.
Councilman Denny?
Here.
Councilman Edgar?
Here.
Councilman Hall? Mayor Copen?
Here.
Councilman Lee?
Here.
Councilman Mangini? Councilman Stokes?
Here.
Councilman Suzak?
Here.
Councilman Arnone?
Here.
Councilman Bosco? Councilman Sakala?
Here.
There's 8 members present and 3 are absent.
Okay, for our fire evacuation, actually, before I do that, just so everyone knows, Councilman Mangini's out of town on vacation and trying to make her way back to the Northeast. I don't know why she wants to come back to all the snow, but she's on a planned family vacation. And Councilman Bosco, because of the snowstorm today, is out plowing. And so one's enjoying the sun and one's moving snow, so but they both contacted me and wanted me to let folks know where they are. And actually, here comes Councilman Bosco. So if he's supposed to plow your lot and he hasn't done so, he'll do after the council meeting. For the fire evacuation announcement, I remind everyone in town hall that in the event the fire alarm sounds, everyone must evacuate the building. Closest exit would be to the rear of council chambers and out to the front of town hall. But if you choose to take the side door, which is to your right and our left, we then ask that you take the back set of stairs to the back parking lot of town hall. Minutes of the preceding meetings, we have 3 minutes to adopt. The first would be, or is, the special meeting of February 3rd, 2014.
So moved.
Motion by Councilman Edgar, seconded by Councilman Sakala. Any discussion on the minutes? Sensing none, by a show of hands, all those in favor, those opposed, any abstentions? Unanimous. Regular meeting, February 3rd, 2014. By Councilman Edgar, seconded by Councilman Stokes. Discussion? Sensing none, show of hands, all those in favor, those opposed, any abstentions? Unanimous. And finally, the special meeting of February 8th, 2014. By Councilman Denny, seconded by Councilman Sakala. Discussion? Sensing none, show of hands, all those in favor, those opposed, any abstentions? One abstention. Where's your beard, Joey?
Who is that guy down there? I didn't recognize
who it was.
That's right.
Got in a fight with a ranger. Just take him off.
All right. And that's unanimous as well. Next item on the agenda is our special guest section of the agenda. And I'd like to call forward Tom Kensler for a presentation on random acts of kindness. Welcome, Tom. And Kevin Kibbe.
Chief Preventure.
And Chief Preventure.
No, I was going to say.
Who somehow looks phenomenal for being 100 years old.
Is that air?
Sure.
If you want, I'll get you another one you can use with your timer.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for having us tonight. This week marks a week that calls Random Acts of Kindness Week, and we come before you today to bring light one of Enfield's shining examples of just that. And her name is Rita Neal. Rita has been a crossing guard and a supervisor of crossing guards for our town since 1978. Those of you that have had the good fortune in the morning or in the afternoon of driving down Brainerd Road will have found a smiling, waving Rita to make your day a little bit brighter. I have in my hands, and I'm going to hand it to Rita when we're done, the Facebook post and all of the outpouring of accolades, kind words, and just amazing comments that were instantly flooded on Facebook the day this post came out. And her daughter wanted me to put that together and give it to her so she could read what the people were saying about her. And unlike other things in our life, this was one example where every single of these comments that are on here were from the heart, were just heartwarming, positive comments. And they speak volumes for what people in this town feel about Rita. One I'd like to read for you is from Carol Dyer, who couldn't be here tonight. I wish I had known about this earlier. I am puppy sitting for a few days, and I cannot drive in the snow. Please give Rita my best wishes and thanks for all she has done for me and others for so many years. She will do anything to help anyone at any time, and with a smile on her face. I have known her for over 40 years since my boys were small. She was always ready to help with anything at St. Adalbert School. She is one of a kind, and I congratulate her and wish her the best. Please read this for me tonight, from Carol Dyer. Tom Sirard couldn't be here tonight because they're having budget meetings tonight for the Board of Ed, but he sent on their behalf another note I'd like to read, and that is, tonight we celebrate wonderful Rita Neal and her 35-plus years of service to Enfield. Most of us know her as the friendly crossing guard that has waved to everyone driving down Brainerd Road and passing Prudence Crandall School when school was in session. A fixture of the town of Enfield that always made the day a little brighter with a simple act of a friendly greeting, for no other reason than to be friendly, regardless of the weather or the kind of day she might be having. We celebrate her because she reminds us of how far a simple act of kindness can go and how every one of us has a chance to make a positive impact on the world every day in everything we do, if we just took the time to do it. I'm sure I speak for every member of the Board of Education when I say thank you, Rita, not just for the example you set for our children, but for the example you set for all of Enfield. Warmest regards, Tom Sirard, Chairman, Board of Education. And with that, I present to you these gentlemen, and then we want to have Rita come up.
Kevin Kibbe, thank you very much for having me. Like I said, I've driven up and down. I've got my four girls have been in the school systems forever, and she's just always been that one that was always make you happy. If you're having a bad day and you're driving up and down Brainerd Road, you can't help but smile. And it brought me, about 2 weeks ago, I was thinking about, it was a little late, and I'm thinking, oh, shoot, I missed her today. But I saw the van there, but it was after school, so I'm like, well, darn, I'm going to miss her. But as I'm driving by on a snowy afternoon, behind the windshield of the van, I see this. So that was just like, you know, like I was saying, you know, you can't not feel better about whatever it is, you know, you may be going through, whether it's good or bad. You cannot help but feel better having just driven past her, let alone meeting her. Thank you.
Thanks. Earl Provencher, Foxcroft Road. And, you know, I've got quite a few occasion that I drive down Brainerd Road all times of the day. And my wife Connie and I have known Rita since as long as she's been there as a crossing guard. On a personal note, she's got a heart that's as big as this room. And in my opinion, I've always said this: if half the people in this world had a heart and had the kindness that Rita Neal has, this world would be a lot better off. You know, we go down Brainerd Road quite often for fire calls. And when we go down, what I was going to say was when I first started going by and Rita was at the crossing guard, I always thought that I knew her and she waves to me. And then as time went on, I said, she's waving to that person. She's waving to that person. It doesn't make any difference who you are, whether you're from Enfield or surrounding communities, a visitor. You will get a smile and a wave from Rita, and that's just one of the things that makes her so kind, and her, she truly means it, knowing her. And so what I was going to say is we go down there for fire calls, and we'll have lights and siren going down Brainerd Road. And don't you know that she'll wave to the guys on the truck when it goes by, and they wave back as they're going by. So it's just an amazing thing, and she's an icon on that corner. And I'm just proud to say she's my friend and my wife Connie as well. So thank you.
Great. Now we can all go. Yeah?
With that, we'll present you with Rita Neal.
Tom Earl Kent, come on up.
Yeah.
Welcome.
Thank you.
So, Rita, is this a surprise?
Yeah.
A bit of a surprise?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, I want to thank Tom, Kevin, and Earl, and all the folks that are gathered here that approached the town about being able to do a random act of kindness designation or recognition. And when I saw the Facebook postings and the comments and the concern, everyone needing to keep it secret from Rita, we were wondering, are you on Facebook or not?
No.
No.
I don't even have a computer.
So we knew it could stay. it's a great outpouring of support. And on behalf of the town, we have a proclamation for you that I'd like to read. And then if you feel up to it, I'm going to hand over the microphone if you'd like to say a couple of words. So this is from your town, the town of Enfield. Proclamation honoring Rita Neal on Random Acts of Kindness Day. Whereas in the heart of all of us lies the idea that we hold the power of kindness within us. And whereas by knowing, understanding, and using this power, we have the ability to send out a positive ripple that may travel for miles. And whereas Rita Neal started as a crossing guard on September 1st, 1978, at the corner of Washington and Brainerd Road, and she worked at that post for just about 11 years before moving to Prudence Crandall. And whereas Rita is in her 36th year as a crossing guard, dispersing hundreds of personal waves and hellos to students as they walk to and from school, and whereas while school crossing guards must have a deep sense of responsibility, a great deal of character, an excellent relationship with children, and the dedication necessary to brave the elements, Rita takes it a step further by taking the time to brighten our day and affect the residents of Enfield in her own positive way. And whereas we seek to cultivate caring, kindness, and compassion within our community through random acts of kindness, which are embodied daily by the actions of Rita Neal. Now therefore I, Scott Copen, Mayor of the Town of Enfield, on behalf of the Town Council, the Town Administration, and the entire community, recognize Rita Neal on Random Acts of Kindness Day and encourage all citizens to follow her example, remembering that no act of kindness is ever wasted and should be a part of our day every day. Signed today, February 18th, 2014. And to you, Rita, on behalf of a very grateful community, thank you for your continuing random acts of kindness day in and day out. We appreciate, we love you, and we thank you for all you do for our community.
Thank you very much.
So we have a stop sign before we turn this over to you. And thank you, Tom, for giving this. And every council member signed it. So I don't know if this is issue stop sign, like you can use this out on your corner. Now, Tom did promise that he has a second one that I get to use here at council meetings, which is really cool. But this is for you as well.
Thank you.
And I'll turn over the microphone.
Yes.
Thank you very much. I think all the school crossing guards are very dedicated, and they do a good service to town. I'm very fortunate and lucky to have a wonderful family and wonderful friends. And we work under the Enfield Police Department, and in my time I've been in crossing guard, I've been under Chief Walter Scowers, Chief Herbie Foy, Chief Ronnie Marcotte, and the present Chief Carl Sferrazza, and our present boss is Sergeant Mark Squires. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And it's my pleasure because I love my job. Thank you.
Folks have some other things for you here, too.
Now, I do remind the audience that we do have public communication, so if any of you want to come up and give your own personal commentary on Rita, you're free to do so, too. So, okay. And again, Tom and Kevin and Earl, thank you for the presentation under special guests. And to Rita and her family, thank you so much for all you do for Enfield and especially the kids here in Enfield. Next item on the agenda is public communications and petitions. Is there anyone in the audience wishing to address the council? Anyone in the audience wishing to address the council? For the third time, anyone in the audience wishing to address the council? Sensing none, we will move to councilman communications and petitions. Anyone from the council? Councilman Denny.
Yes, I like to bring up, it might be a little bit of a sore subject, but I went to a Housing Authority meeting a week ago Monday. I was given some letters by the board of directors that were addressed not only to the town manager but to the previous liaisons to the committee. And some of the letters they're saying, and I'll read part of it. It says, as you are aware, the Enfield Housing Authority is seeking to negotiate a lease with the town of Enfield for adult daycare center, and the current lease has expired in 2009. Some of their major concerns is that the facility is now over 20 years of age and is likely needing a sufficient improvements. One of their issues is that the people, the town manager, so they say, and us, I guess, the council, have been ignoring them to sit down and meet with them. And so they told me they would like me to address you. All of us to look into this issue. They have proposals. I'm sure you've received the letters, Matt, at some point. And I'll leave it at that.
Thank you, Ed. Councilman Arnone.
Would like to add congratulations to Rita. Four of my children are walkers to Prudence Crandall. Three of my grandchildren. I don't really know her personally, but I feel I know her. So I really appreciate the hard work she does. And it's always great to be able to send your child as a walker to school and know you have the best people at those crosswalks, especially on the busy roads, Brainerd Road, and roads like that around town. So thank you for your dedicated service. Dances with Enfield, great job, Matt. And all the town staff, we had a fantastic evening. Very entertaining. Had my wife there, too. We had a date night out. Looking forward to next year. And fantastic job of all the social services, too, on that.
You'll be dancing next year? Is that what I hear?
I have two left feet. And you'll have to get me dragging and kicking on that one. That's too, I don't. Thank you, but no thank you. Anywhere else I can help, I would be glad to. Athletic Hall of Fame, a golf tournament on May 18th. If you go, if you'd like to get a group out golfing to help support their cause, get on the website for the Enfield Athletic Hall of Fame. Let's hope not. And they're looking for sponsors also. Pearl Street 100th anniversary, they're looking for ideas for the time capsule. They're going to put a time capsule in for the anniversary, and they would like you to go online and give your ideas on what you can put in today into that time capsule that can be opened. I think it's in 75 years. Heritage Fair was a great success. I want to thank Amy Whitbrow and the Enfield school system for putting on that event. It was just awesome. You can see it on ETV. Got about an hour and some change film on it, interviewing people that were there. It should be running soon. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Councilman Stokes?
Just a couple of things. First of all, the Enfield 4th of July Town Celebration Committee has their annual dinner dance coming up on March 8th. And if you would like to go, we have tickets. I have tickets. Scott does. A few of us do. It's going to be a wonderful evening. It's always our kickoff for the season. This is our 30th year on the town green with the 4th of July, and we're bringing back some of the favorites. Marshall Tucker, Dickie Betts, the Savage Brothers will be with us this coming July. But it always kicks off in this dinner dance, and it's a great time. So see any of us or our Facebook page for information there. But it's coming up pretty quick, so we invite you. I also want to mention, and I know that the mayor is probably going to say something, but I want to acknowledge this past weekend, Saturday night, the North Thomasville Fire Department celebrated their 100th year of service, the gala they had up in Springfield. And my wife and I were able to go and spend the night at the hotel there and then have the midnight toast, which it was, we were all still wide awake and alert. You mix coffee with everything else you're drinking, you're pretty good. But anyways, it was a great night, a great celebration. And seeing some of the younger firefighters coming up, it just gives us a lot of hope because a lot of young men and women that are really great at serving the community. But I wanted to acknowledge Chief Prevent, Sharon Connie, who are here this evening, and congratulate them and all the fine people there. So we had a great time. Thank you.
Thank you, Greg. Councilman Suzak.
Okay, yesterday I had a great day. Went over to Fermi where the robotics were ending up there, finishing up the build. And I understand as of today at 6 o'clock, everything was buttoned up and ready for competition. And right now we have 23 students involved there, and they have logged over 2,500 hours. So it's a pretty intensive program, and to go and watch it, it was sort of like they don't mind the audience. They are busily working, and the mentor program is it's just an excellent way for kids to get involved in engineering and building things. And also on February 28th, they have a pasta supper at St. Bernard's, and that's their fundraiser. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Donna. Councilman Hall.
Tom already mentioned this, but I have to add on because it was such a great event, Dancing with the Town this year, and some of our stars, Matt Koppler, and our head of personnel, Steve Belinda, were some of the dancers, along with Captain Jeff Golden, who actually won the event this year and did an interesting dance, to say the least. So it was a great event, and what made it even better was we raised $10,000 for social service, which was phenomenal. It was a fun event. Cindy and I, who's not here tonight, but we were judges, and it was certainly easier to be on that side of the table, Matt, this year after dancing last year. So I suggest moving to that side of the table. It was definitely a better spot to be. So great event, and it grows better every year. So come out and support this event. So much fun. And I wanted to congratulate Earl's department for the 100-year anniversary. Fred and I were out of town. Wish we could be there to celebrate with you, but we did want to wish you a congratulations and thank you to all your amazing personnel that you have working there. So thank you, Earl.
Thanks, Carol. Councilman Bosco?
Yeah, through the mayor, to the town manager. Sledding and Tobogganing Hill. I mean, this is the first year in a long time that they can really enjoy it, and it never gets plowed. You can see all the tracks where everyone rolls over to snow, but, I mean, I think we should worry about that and get it plowed so they can use it with all the snow. I guess my complaint I had on the plowing, Jonathan took care of today. So he addressed it, and I guess they'll be looking into that. The next thing that bothers me is... And I'm only going to use one intersection as, for instance, Wallop School Road. That pile had to be 5 feet high, and no one could see. Now, I would hope that our town employees driving by the fire department, just if they see something like that, report it, because it was really pretty dangerous. I mean, I called in, and it got taken care of, and that's... all, but even to the residents out there, if you see something that's hard to navigate around, please call, because it could be someone's life you're saving. If someone can't see, there could be a big issue. So don't ever feel funny that you're going to be a pain or anything. Just call. Call the town hall. You can call any of the councilmen, and we'll get that taken care of if it's a safety issue. And I'm all done. Thank you.
Thanks, Joey. Councilman Hall, go ahead.
Just to piggyback on what Joey said, driving around town, because I do a lot of it, and there are a ton of site problems with these huge piles. So I'm wondering if Jonathan is getting out there, and maybe with all this extra snow, if he could maybe drive around and take a look at the line of sight issues, because I know just pulling out of, I would say, almost a majority of the streets, there's some monstrous piles, and I know coming out onto Abbey with those side streets, you actually have to pull all the way out into the first lane to even see. So maybe he needs to kind of drive around and check all the intersections out, because it really is bad. Thank you.
Thanks, Carol. Councilman Denny?
Yes, I'd just like to thank the crossing guard again. I had four children go there that she ushered across the street or around, and also four grandchildren. Thank you.
Thanks, Ed. Deputy Mayor Lee.
Yeah, want to share the sentiment for Rita tonight. It's a great honor, and I thought her remarks were rather touching, and sharing the accolades with her colleagues really shows, you know, what kind of person we have out there. And certainly, like Tom said, you can feel that there's someone who's been pretty dedicated and knows, takes the time to know the children and understand the importance of their safety. And I've never seen her out there, so actually I'm gonna take a ride tomorrow morning.
I just wanted to wave at you.
Secondly, I want to piggyback something Councilman Arnone had mentioned about the Pearl Street Library celebration. I see online under the Enfield Public Library website, there is now a list of the events, and one of them that was announced this week is going to be a townwide family scavenger hunt. And I believe they're starting to accept registrations for that, and I believe it's mid-April, April 18th or 19th. But the details are making their way to the website shortly. From a housekeeping perspective tonight, Scott, I'd like to make a motion to suspend the rules and move the following items, A1 and A2, B1, D, E, and F. I'd like to move all those to miscellaneous and proceed to a vote on each item.
Motion by Deputy Mayor Lee, seconded by Councilman Hall. Any discussion on moving those items to miscellaneous? Sensing none, by a show of hands, all those in favor? Those opposed? Any abstentions?
I have a couple questions. I'll wait for the town manager's report.
Okay. Any other councilman communications? I have just a couple. First,
Matt, to you and to all the staff that accompanied us and were part of the goal-setting tour on February 8th. Even though I've been at this for quite a few years, you still learn something new when you're visiting around. You see some of the problems that we've been facing year after year. You see advancements, especially going into the Public Works garage and seeing the new dump truck that was there and some of the new acquisitions, street sweeping and the trash trucks. But making the tours around the senior center, the police department, buildings and grounds, which is very historic. But it was, you know, to have to spend a day, but we learned a lot. And thanks. And what we would like to do is, we talked about it after the goal setting, is have Kevin Schlatz from Water Pollution Control come in and do the demonstration that we did at the end of the tour. So I won't give it away, but it's a great visual that folks from the town will learn. It's nothing gross, but it has to deal with water pollution control.
Pretty simple.
It's pretty simple, but I know it's a big task to put that together and appreciate everyone's participation. A couple folks have mentioned the Dancing with the Town. Great event. Thanks to all the organizers, the participants, the professional dancers. You could see the difference in support, attendance, sponsorships from year number one to year number two. And that's what we told the organizers last year, is that if you get Matt Coppler to dance, people are going to come and bust down the doors. No. You know, hats off to them. It was a really nice night out to meet up with folks and get support there for Enfield Social Services. Also, hats off to Chief Earl Preventure and all the men and women of North Thompsonville Fire Department. 100 years, beautiful night up at the Sheridan in Springfield. Honored the service of many folks and just proud to be able to be part of it. And to see the many years of service, and there's volunteer service, there's professional service, folks that are volunteer commissioners are there, those that were associated or affiliated with the fire department, but their volunteer years are over, came back to celebrate 100 years. And it's a milestone. It was right to celebrate it. So thanks, Earl, to all your men and women for your service to our town. And we're a better community because of the work that you folks do. So with the 100th for North Thompsonville, now plans are starting for the 175th of the Thompsonville Fire District. And so you're going to start seeing some information come out about Thompsonville. So really, you look at the town of Enfield, you have two fire departments, 175, 100, and I'm not sure of the ages of Hazardville, Shaker Pines, and Enfield, but pretty remarkable.
Enfield's over 100.
Enfield's over 100 already. So, but thanks to all. One event coming up that people did not mention is First Readers. First Readers has their annual trivia night on Saturday, February 22nd. Doors open at 6 p.m. It's at Mount Carmel. The event itself begins at 7. So if you're a trivia buff, I'm sure you can reach out to the organizers of First Readers and find if there's still some table availability or people need some ringers to join their team. We have our quarterly public informational meeting on Monday, February 24th. At Parkman School, 7 p.m. This is the opportunity for folks to come and address council and staff in an open Q&A session. No topic is off limits. So we start at 7. We typically go for a couple hours of dialogue back and forth. So Monday, February 24th, 7 p.m. at Parkman School. Councilman Stokes mentioned the 4th of July winter dance on March 8th, 6 p.m. at the Polish Home. Please come out and support the 4th of July celebration. And my last comments is to the council. We've got a couple of us are visiting Advanced Auto tomorrow morning, meeting with the leadership at Advanced Auto, and we'll report back. And what I'd like to do, one of the things I'm gonna is the ask and takeaway from going there, is have a time where the council can come and do a tour. So have the full council go in and tour the facility. I'm sure they've done a lot of re-engineering the distribution center. Be interesting to see what they're actually doing there. And we'll try to set something up for everybody.
To let people know where it is.
So Advance Auto is on Taylor Road. They took over the distribution center of Lego. So it's on Taylor and Shaker, and it's that very large building at the right across the street from Carl Robinson off on Shaker Road. Any what's that?
Angels.
Yeah. any other councilman communications? Any other councilman communications? Sensing none, we'll go to the town manager's report and communication. Matt?
I was thinking that you had some theme music there for wrapping up your...
Well, Advance Auto, it should don't be some car easy. Theme,
yeah.
Right?
So.
That was introducing you. And
good thoughts. With
positive. Well, I have a couple very long presentations tonight for you. Lynn Nenny, Director of Finance, is going to be given an update on the sewer billing.
And this won't take long at all. The sewer billing project is moving along nicely. We received the first set of consumption data from both water companies, and I've given that to the billing company, and they're working on matching up the water company records with our land records. We're working with the bank to set up the lockbox. People will make payments to the lockbox similar to the way they make the tax payments to the lockbox. And the first set of bills should be in the mail the week of March 3rd.
Questions for Lynn?
Questions on that so far? There's more to talk about, but...
Okay. Councilman Denny?
The lockbox. Are we paying for the lockbox or are they paying for the lockbox? The billing company?
We are.
We are. Yeah. And how much is that?
I don't have a definite price on that yet, but I can get you one.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilman Bosco?
Wasn't that lockbox their responsibility, the billing company, in the bid?
I don't believe so.
Can I get an answer on that?
Yeah.
Councilman Sakala.
That was my question.
The lockbox?
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't know why we were paying for it. And I got my bill. It has it on there.
No,
I have a bill.
No, you shouldn't have the sewer bill yet. We haven't mailed any out
it's
yet.
It's a different one. I have the water bill as well. It's on the water bill, too.
Well, the water bill is not sent out by the town.
Right. But the...
What is the WPCA?
WICA.
What is that? Let me see it.
That's the Water Infrastructure Conservation Adjustment. Does that have to do with it, too?
Nope.
No?
No.
Then forget I said anything.
Councilman Edgar.
Yes. As I recall the original contract, the way it was explained to me, the bills were supposed to go out the first week of February, not the first week of March.
Well, we had to meet with the water companies and get everybody together and make some changes to the way that the water companies pull data so we could get the right data to send to the company.
And the other thing, as I understand it, the Luxbox was in the original thing that the, whoever got the contract would pay for it. And as I recall, the item on it was $14,000. Now, what I'm wondering here, I might be wrong, but it was also suggested they use the lockbox that the tax assessor uses for taxes, and there would be no cost to the town. But correct me if I'm wrong. Doesn't this, don't these two things change the original bid that went out?
I don't believe that we required the, in the bid that we required the billing company to pay for the lockbox.
I beg to disagree with you, and I'd like to see it in writing.
Okay.
All set, Red. Councilman Suzak.
I just had a question. I know the water company bills us according to either 1,000 cubic feet or cubic feet of water, and but we're billing in gallons.
Right. That's
why
right.
Do we choose to do that?
That's the way the sewer fee structure was set up, in gallons.
I know, but it could be set up so that it would be apples to apples. And now,
Connecticut water is gallons.
Right. Connecticut water is gallons, and Hazardville water is cubic feet.
It's 100 cubic feet.
Right. So we have to make a conversion.
Connecticut water is cubic feet. I get a Connecticut water bill. I just, you know, it's just one of those things as you start to get into this and you start to look at it, you know, it's like, you know, we're all sitting there converting and doing all these things where if we had kept the same, you know, basis of our, we could more easily. Yeah. Right, that's right, cubic feet of it. But it's just a question, you know, and you sit there and, you know, you talk to the residents and you're sitting there and you're converting your bill so you can understand how many gallons you used. All of a sudden you say, gee, if everything was on the same basis, it would be a whole lot easier.
Councilman Edgar.
Yes. The contract you signed with the company is for how long?
It's for a 1 year period with an option to renew for another year.
I thought the original.
There's a contract that goes to the end of this fiscal year, and then there's a renewal for another year after that, and then we'll negotiate whether or not we want to extend the contract another year after that.
Well, again, I would ask you to check because, as I remember, it was 6 months originally, then renewable for a year or two.
Right.
I mean,
isn't that what I just said? That's what I meant to say.
It expires at the end of the fiscal year.
Now, is it for 6 months and then renewed for a year after that, or what? I'm not
right.
Sure.
It's for 6 months and it's renewed for a year after that. The reason we do that is a recommendation from the legal department that the contracts not span fiscal years. So we do that with all our contracts.
All set. Anyone, Councilman Denny?
Is it an automatic renewal? So 6 months, and we're automatically renewing it for a year?
Yeah.
With nobody else that's going to bid?
Right.
If I could, Councilman Denny, I believe it's a town option to renew. It's not an automatic renewal. Correct.
The plan is not to go out to bid again, though.
Right.
At the end of 6 months.
Then why is that? It's not an option, but yet the plan is we're not going to bid it.
Well, the option is there if there is something that is totally, you know, not what was represented to us. If they are not able to meet the goals and the needs that we have to provide that service, then we have the ability at the end of the first 6 months to get out and find another company to do that. And again, this is kind of standard what we do with all of our contracts. They're 1 year contracts, renewable for the next year.
Well, we already have problems now because we're talking about a lockbox that the town's going to pay for this lockbox, and I was under the impression, like most were, that the lockbox was being paid by the company that's billing, doing the billing. And also, now we have another problem that Donna brought up, that now we're converting from gallons to...
Yeah, just to let you know, Derek pulled up the bid specifications, and there's nothing in the bid specs about a lockbox.
I think we wrote that may be an option, that we may want to use a lockbox, but I don't believe that we required the billing company to provide that service.
Councilman Bosco.
And I, by all means, I don't want to overstep my bounds, and if I'm overstepping my bounds, please tell me. But I'd like to see a copy of the bid spec that went out. Yeah. That way, we're all on the same page, because sometimes what gets translated to us is not the actual truth, and or someone may read it a different way. So I'd like to see a copy of it, and that way, at least... I can read what went on and then go, I'm not happy with something that just says, that gives you assumption that it starts off at 6 months and you may not have an option to renew it. I would have rather seen it, you know, maybe word a little different. But until I read it, I can't say much. So I'd like to just see it. Thank you.
Councilman Hall.
And I was going to ask what Joey just asked for. And I guess depending on how that looks and... when we get to the six-month threshold, I'm wondering if we don't need to revisit it. I mean, if it's open-ended and it's not a automatic, like our town attorney said, maybe it needs to come back and we need to discuss it. So let's take a look at the documents and then go from there.
Deputy Mayor Lee. Yeah.
Quick question. Assuming that everything starts rolling here at the beginning of the next month, what can you tell us about the steps your department or other departments are taking here at Town Hall to prepare staff for the customer service issues that are going to begin arising once invoices start hitting the mail? How is that progressing?
The plan is that the billing company would field all the phone calls that come in related to the billing.
Is there that's going to be in the bill?
Those are the instructions on the bill.
So if someone walks into the lobby here with a bill in hand and wants to talk about it, how is that going to be organized?
Well, we'll help them out the best we can, but we'll direct them to the billing company to resolve the issues.
Okay. All right. I had some conversations with Matt over the last few weeks about irrigation and other exceptions where folks are using a large amount of outside water. And I've been looking, and I think Matt has as well, what other communities around the state and New England do in those scenarios. Is maybe Scott through you to Matt. Is there an option here as the WPCA to make sure that we have the right protocols in place to deal with those? And how would you suggest the council move on those?
Yeah, and just to kind of give a background on our discussion, I know a number of residents had contacted Councilman Lee about that very issue of, you know, their very high usage during the summer months, and they felt that the 7.5% per month, or about 23% over that quarter, wasn't sufficient to offset their costs. And Councilman Lee actually done some research and provided us some different examples of how other communities have dealt with that. And it would look like the best way to deal with it, if council wanted, or the WPCA wanted to deal with that, is to update the adjustment policy that would allow for a second meter and So they could have a second inline meter, so a meter on the irrigation system, and then make that an, or give then residents the ability to make a request for adjustment based upon that second meter. But again, if we, you know, they do have that ability now to put a second meter in, and most likely the water company would be reading that, and if the water company wasn't reading the second meter or deduct meter effectively, you know, we'd have set a protocol then to have that read. And I know a lot of communities deal with that with, you know, basically a postcard where you give that to the resident, and they write what the numbers are on the deduct meter, and then the billing company would make that adjustment. The community would most likely audit that occasionally just to make sure that the meter is working properly and, you know, there isn't a loss. So there's, those are the two ways that I see this can be dealt with. One, which we are going to, as we talked, bring back to the WPCA maybe at the next meeting and discuss the amendment to the policy.
So just in terms of making sure that all that is in place maybe before folks start uncapping their sprinklers, which at this rate it'll be in August. but I mean, I'm concerned that we ensure that we have that kind of laid out customer-friendly manner, perhaps even a few folks that are willing to be our pilots. Yep. And I've got some additional ideas that I'll share with you offline on how that audit process takes place or how some communities permit that deduct meter and it works fairly smoothly. So, you know, for colleagues up here, I think we just want to make sure we have the ample time at our next WPCA opportunity to meet to go over that.
Yep.
Okay.
And that's what the plans are, is on the 3rd to have that first meeting.
The next meeting, meaning our next, okay.
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Yep.
Now it makes sense. All set.
Councilman Edgar.
Well, I'm more than a little upset on this. What I would want is the documents that were given to the different people that bid on this. I want to see the original document there so that I can see what those people looked at and how they bid and what they were required to bid on.
You mean the responses to the RFP? Is that what
you wanted? No, he was asking for the actual RFP, which, by the way, Derek emailed that to everybody.
If he bid and I bid, we were given a document to file and fill out and tell us what the requirements were. I want that document, and I would like it delivered to my house tomorrow morning.
Matt, did you say that the document's been emailed out already?
Y'all have it.
Yeah, Derek emailed that out.
Okay, so that went to the town council distribution?
Yes. Correct.
Okay. So, Red, it's delivered to your email box already?
I haven't seen it.
Well, it got sent to just a couple
now.
Minutes ago.
8:02.
Just a couple minutes ago?
Yep.
Yes. Moments ago.
No way I can look at it.
Technology.
Well, if I have questions, I'll be on the phone.
Okay. All right. Anyone else? Questions for Lynn? Lynn, was that your presentation, or did we preempt anything else that you wanted to say?
Well, I also wanted to mention that we'll be sending the bills out on a monthly basis. The bills that are going out in March are for reads that occurred during January. So the first 3 months of bills that go out will be prorated until the read date is after April 1st. That makes sense? So, for example, a read date for January 15th by the water company is for the prior three-month period. And the ordinance didn't go into effect until January 1st. So you will only be paying if your read date was January 15th for 15 days of sewer usage. So the bills that are sent out for read dates prior to April 1st, because a read date of April 1st would include January, February, and March. So for bills sent out with read dates before April 1st, it will be prorated so that you're only paying for services after January 1st.
Right. Bill.
So it'll be based on, I mean, I'm going to speak from a Hazardville water bill, and Gina, if you've got the Connecticut bill there, chime in. On the Hazardville Water Company bill, there is the total usage and the number of days in that cycle. So am I understanding you correctly that the bill, the first bill that folks get under this program is going to be based on the average daily usage of the period prior, starting January 1?
Well, we'd take the usage for the entire period, for the three-month period, yep, and divide it by the number of days in the
number
billing
of days.
Cycle.
Okay. Yeah. And that's what is reflected on the bill.
Right. And that's, if you remember, that's exactly what we had said, how we were going to do that, because the first three sets of bills, so the first three-quarter billings that are, yep, going to happen are going to be not for a full quarter of usage.
Right.
Now, Councilman Edgar, it's we're billing monthly, yeah, but a third of the population are receiving invoices, yeah, every, you know, per quarter. And so to get to the first full quarter, there's monthly bills, you know, for
the first 15 days.
Right. Because the water company bills only a segment of their, right, user, so, base each month.
So to explain what she said, you know, from our perspective, we're going to be sending bills out every month. The resident, the individual resident, is not going to get a bill every month.
Right.
But because of the way that the water companies bill, it effectively causes us to be billing on a monthly basis. Different quarters,
right,
different segments of the town, but we'll be billing monthly. The resident will be receiving a quarterly bill. Exactly.
And I also wanted to mention that the town's website at the Water Pollution Control homepage is a good resource for information. It's got the sewer ordinance. It has the fee schedule. There's the calculator that you can use to estimate what your bill will be. There's one for Hazardville Water, and there's one for Connecticut Water. The usage adjustment policy is posted there. What I don't have posted yet at that website is the form to fill out if you would like to request an adjustment to your bill.
Scott, if I may,
yeah.
Matt, could you just go through that page with Lynn's staff and the IT staff tomorrow just to pull down any of the documents that are there that were leading up to the adoption? Because if you look out there right now, there's, you know, 15 items, and only three of them, I think, are really
pertinent
since we adopted the policy. It might make it a little bit easier for folks to understand.
And Deb and Maya in the town manager's office have been fielding most of the phone calls that came in, and they've been doing a really good job at trying to help people understand the billing and transition over to the new program. So they deserve a lot of credit, too.
Any further comments? Thank you, Lynn.
Okay.
And for another lengthy presentation, we have... See, is it John and Donald and Bill? Oh, Jonathan's coming up. You're going to preface it?
I'm going to.
So, Jonathan Bilmes.
Very brief, and I'm going to turn it over to the other staff, who I'll introduce in a minute. We wanted to come to you today to talk a little bit about the Mullen Road work and the design, preliminary design, because the next thing we need to do or want to do is go and have a public meeting, and we thought it would be a good idea just to let you know what some of the issues are before we open that up to the public. And before I turn it over, we last year we had numerous meetings with the council on the balance of the roads 2010 funding, and Mullen Road was a piece of that. We're not here tonight to go regurgitate all that. We did, at the DPW subcommittee, hand out a summary and talked about it, talked about the roads program for the DPW subcommittee folks. And one of the people I want to introduce tonight, you do know Billy Taylor, who's a transportation expert and made numerous presentations on this last year. I also wanted to make sure you met Donald Nunes, who's our roads engineer. He's been with us a little less than 4 months. And you will be seeing him quite a bit as we move towards the presentations on the roads 2015 referendum. So I wanted him to come tonight just so you could meet him and put a face to the name so he could get a chance to see you in this venue. So I'm going to turn it over to Billy Taylor, Donald Nunes, and John Kibibbo on the roads engineering for a brief presentation.
Good evening. I'm Bill Taylor. I think I've met all of you by now. Just so you're straight on who's who, Donald is to my far right, and John Kibibbo, our assistant town engineer, is to my immediate right. As Jonathan said, we're just here to talk about one element of the Roads 2010 program, and that's Mullen Road. And for the benefit of councilmen who were not here for the lengthy discussion and series of meetings that we had last spring, there was a concern on the part of members of council that something needed to be done on Mullen Road, specifically at points that the road, I guess I'd call them pinch points for lack of a better term. There are five cross culverts on that road, pipes underneath the road, and at each one of those points there's guide rail. The road that exists out there is approximately 21 feet wide. So with the traffic that exists out there, and especially the truck traffic that exists, there was a feeling that that the width is unsafe, and specifically at those points where the culverts are, the guide rail right up next to the edge of the road, and it was felt that width was inadequate. So during the course of the debate that we engaged in and over those meetings in the spring, we came forward with a proposal to do some selective widening of that road at the of Mullen Road at those five points. So the design engineer that has been working on the project has completed preliminary design drawings, and I think you were provided with a reduced size set of those drawings that shows those five culverts being extended with new either end walls, wing walls, or flared end sections on those pipes that would allow us to eventually widen a road to a width of 30 feet. What we're proposing to do at this point is, in addition to extending those culverts, reconstruct about a 175-foot section of the road in the area of the culverts. And in doing so, widen the road slightly from its existing 21 feet to a more standard 24 feet. So you'd have two 12-foot lanes in each direction, 12 feet. In case you're not aware, is the standard lane width used on like an interstate highway. So it would allow traffic to pass more safely at those points. In addition, there would be a stone shoulder that would go out 30 feet to where the new guide rails is going to go. And I think that's pretty much it. The guide rail would all be new standard, up-to-date guide rail with impact attenuators at each end. And so the reason that we we're here is to let you know what's going on and also to say that because the road is so narrow out there, the work that needs to be done will probably necessitate short closings of the road in order to get the work, in order to get these pipes extended. Knowing that that might be an issue with the residents and the users of that road, we are proposing to have a public information meeting in the near future just to present the plans and gather input from the residents and users of the road so that we can finalize the design and get it out to bid. And that's, I think, pretty much summarizes why we wanted to make a report to you.
Questions? Councilman Bosco.
That's great. It's been 6 years in the making to get this done. I'm looking at the prints. The only couple questions I have here is when we get done bumping these out, we're going to make sure the culverts under the road are good. Everything's all set. So this way, when we do have the money to widen the road, we can just go. We don't have to go back over these.
Correct. That's what our aim is.
I just wanted to make sure there. And the next thing is on how are we planning on doing this? I know you're talking about closing the road for short periods of time. Are we planning on getting a company to do multiple ones at the same time so this way we don't have to shut them down five times?
I don't know that we can do that just because of the location of the driveways. We don't want to leave anyone on an island, and unfortunately, based on the location of these culverts, it appears that we're going to have to do it one at a time. Because if we do two, there'll be driveways in between where we won't be able to get to for safety reasons. It's one thing to close the road to through traffic. Obviously, we'd be able to get in from both ends, but to do two at once, we'd leave someone on an island.
That was my question, if there was a way of doing multiple ones so we don't have to close the road five times instead of, you know, maybe two or three.
Yeah. And the narrowness of the road and that the road drops off on the sides, it's not like we have space to work around.
Great. We're moving in the right direction, and I'm glad that we're going to do this, and it's going to be a permanent fixture, so we're not wasting money like we've been over the past, just trying to put blacktop to shim it and just make it work. At least now we have a plan, and we can see we're going in the right direction. Thank you.
Thank you, Joey. Councilman Edgar, then Councilman Suzak.
Well, I'm happy to see that because I can tell you right now, if you come upon one of them trucks, which I have when I've been down in the area, you have to stop because it's impossible to get by. And it's not only where some of the culverts are. It's part of the complete road. And I'm glad to see we're doing away with the Band-Aid approach. But are you people aware that some of those residents have wells and we're going to have to look that we don't disturb the wells? Some of them use wells for their drinking water and everything. And I'm not sure, looking quickly at this, that you're aware of that. And I think you should be.
We'll take a look at that.
Yeah, I don't think any of the work that's proposed should affect anyone's well. We're staying within the existing right-of-way. The culverts, aquifers are often fed from surface water. The way this is being designed, we're not going to change the flow of water.
Okay.
So other than extending some pipe, putting on some new end treatments, and then reconstructing a portion of road, I can't imagine it would have an effect on people's wells.
I appreciate that, and I didn't know the answer to it. I just wanted to know if it had been considered. And if you're not in the area of wells and so forth, but I would just check to be sure, but it does, sounds like you've considered it. I just was looking for an answer. I don't know.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Red. Councilman Suzak?
Now, is there any pedestrian traffic that we have on this roadway?
There may be. There's no sidewalk.
I'm looking at it. I don't see a sidewalk. I saw what we did on Town Farm Road where we put the bikeway in there, and it kind of opens up that part of town. I ride my bike, as people know. I'm always calling in potholes.
Now you can do it yourself.
Yeah, I'm not doing it myself. I'm still calling you, Joe. That, you know, Town Farm Road was always one of those roads that's a really good riding road, and now with having that bikeway, it's an even safer road. And I'm just, you know, trying to think that, you know, for passive recreation and things like that, have there been any consideration to this part of this road also getting the benefit of pedestrian traffic?
Well, I think this is the first phase, and I would think in when we get to do the entire length of the road, that would be something obviously that we'd be thinking about.
Yeah, I guess the reason that we're doing what we're doing is because of funding and the limited amount of money that was available to allow us to do this. Frankly, I think, was it just today we had a conversation about bicycle traffic, that when this ultimately gets done, will we have enough room for bicycle traffic? Unfortunately, our constraint is right now is one of the things is the existing right-of-way. If we were to widen a road much more or provide that a pedestrian or a bike facility, we'd need to acquire quite a bit of right-of-way, which is expensive and frankly unpopular among the abutters. But because of the limited budget that we've set and the limited amount of work that we're going to do, we just can't accommodate anything else in terms of pedestrian or bicycles at this point.
All set, Donna? All set. Councilman Denny?
Just a point. The whole road basically is higher, and it's all drops off on both sides, most of it, correct? I mean, some of it is flat, but a lot of it is. There's really a gully if you go off the road there, correct?
That's correct.
So it kind of would be not too feasible to put a bike path in. I mean, you'd have to acquire a lot or build up all of it.
Correct. It would be a major construction project to extend the embankment out.
Exactly, because
of the lower land surrounding it with sloping that would be required, we'd be well onto private property.
Right. And that's what
hence the need to acquire right of way.
Any further questions on Mullen Road? Councilman Bosco.
No. Yes. This year. That's the plan to get it done.
Yeah, we've kind of set a schedule for all our projects, and right now we were originally hoping to have this meeting with the residents next week, but now we're looking at maybe the first week of March. We have an inland wetlands approval coming up, and we'd hope to have final design plans by the end of March. Go to bid in April and begin construction by June.
Can you notify me when the meeting with the neighbors are?
Yes.
And
we'll certainly inform the town manager.
Yeah, let us all know.
And then also, if you have the schedule for all the roads projects that are going to kick off, can we get a copy of that so we can, when we get the phone calls, at least we can tell them that, look, this is the timetable?
Of course.
Thank you.
Further questions, comments?
Get it done.
Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The last item I had was goal setting. I know we had leadership talked about the 25th, but it looks like the 25th is not going to be working. So I guess I look for your direction on when we can plan the goal setting meeting.
So how many people planned on attending? See, I didn't think the ethics training was for us, but if people want to go to it, it's more for the boards and commissions. Yeah, FOI, ethics, that's what I meant. I mean, it's on, honestly, it's more set up for, yes, anyone can go, but it's not on the typically not on the council agenda. So there's Wednesday the 26th.
That's my birthday, so.
So there'll be cake. Yeah, that's right.
Wednesday's bad for me.
No. No. Right, but we do need goals, guys. So it's like, to me, goal setting takes priority over FOI. You're trying to establish the goals for the community and the council. So at some point in time, people's schedules have to give to the priority of the council, and the priority is goal setting. Or we're not going to provide this team direction to set the budget that's due in March to us. So now we're going to March.
What's Kevin's?
No, I'm fine with the 26th, but if we keep.
Joey's not going to be there.
I know. But at some point, we've got to set a day.
I had a problem, but I might be able to change.
Right, why don't we do the 25th? Yeah. Who needs ethics anyway?
25th is bad.
It's Gina Cekala, C-E-K-A-L.
I'll try to catch on. I won't be here at about 8:30.
Joey won't be here.
Right. No, unless we go one more week and we go to Tuesday, March 4th.
Matt, when is your budget presentation?
I can do that.
March 13th. March 17th.
March 17th.
I can do the 4th.
But what this is doing is this is... this is compressing that we have one night to establish our goals. So it doesn't mean that we can just say, okay, we'll get back to you on this. It's like it becomes decision time, where if we keep going a week later, then we don't have the ability to say, have a second meeting to finalize. Now, can everyone make Tuesday the 25th?
I can't.
So we have two that can't make it. Can everyone make Wednesday the 26th?
Yes. Let me go talk to him real quick.
I'll have to change.
It's his birthday.
We're checking with Joey. That's it? We have to buy him dinner? So Wednesday the 26th? Wednesday the 26th?
Wednesday the 26th. Going once?
Sold.
Twice?
Okay. 5:30. And plan on being here till, Matt, would you say like 3 hours, 3+ hours?
I think we can do three and a half hours.
Yeah.
We're going to send out some surveys to kind of make it so we get right to the goal setting. So we'll do some of the preliminary over surveys. Of course.
Would it be goal setting without dots?
Without what?
Dots.
Without dots. Okay.
The candy, yeah.
That was easy. Anything else, Matt?
I am complete.
Anyone have a question for Matt? Gina.
I do. Matt, we had asked to get some numbers on the DPW's budget as far as overtime and materials for the storms.
For snow. Yep, that is coming up under the item we have for the transfer.
Oh, perfect. Thanks.
Yep.
Bill?
Matt or Derek, do you have any follow-up on the traffic-related items over in Hazardville that we've been chugging away at?
So on the two questions, one regarding the North Maple Street speed limit sign, there was a discussion just to get the ball rolling, see where we are on that. Our highway crew leader spoke with the state District 1 traffic engineer and said that they will be installing a 40-mile-per-hour speed limit sign just north of Ryfield Drive in the northbound lane and another 40-mile-per-hour speed limit sign in the southbound lane by Cozy Street. That, I believe, is to conform to the new state standards for signage. Matt, I don't know if you want to talk about there's a lower speed limit sign around Hazardville. I think it's a 30-mile-per-hour sign. I know the issue was maybe we could see if we can get a 25-mile-per-hour sign around there, because I guess there's been some concerns about that. I've asked Public Works and our traffic officer if we could see about conforming as much as possible any state or any town sign regulations with the state sign regulations, just to make sure that everything's mirrored as much as possible. But that's a process that we're just kicking off.
Okay. And the ground's frozen, I realize that. So it'll be a springtime pursuit anyways. Yep. But everyone's clear on what the original request was, that there was no posted speed limit if you were coming off of North Street. That's understood at this point? No one, because there's been apparently traffic enforcement action around the Hazardville Memorial School area, and people who are coming from North Street never have the ability to see a speed limit sign, and that's where this thing started from, because the previous sign is way down towards the Institute. Okay, thank you. I'll follow up with the residents who've been asking.
Any other questions, comments for Matt? Councilman Denny.
Yeah, two things, Derek, about that crosswalk. I just want to make sure that you know we're going to change that crosswalk on Raffier Road, correct, in front of the housing. That's been in the progress. I meant to mention that when I said Housing Authority, because they asked me about that.
Yeah, DPW is going to, they were going to do it at the end of the season last year, but they ran out of time.
That's what I thought.
And so this spring, once everything dries up and clears up, they will move it to the intersection of Post Road where
move it
we
closer.
Talked about before.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the thing I brought up, you're going to get back to me on that, some kind of an answer?
On the Housing Authority?
About the housing.
Yep.
Okay.
We'll do.
Thank you.
Anything else for Matt? Thank you. Town Attorney Report and Communications, Kevin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As was mentioned earlier, a week from tonight, downstairs in the Enfield Room, we're having a program on FOI for all boards, commissions, and including the council, if you'd like to go.
As long as you said if.
And we will also be covering ethics. For anyone who may be watching, we will endeavor to get everyone out in 2 hours. We'll try not to go past 8:30, so... I also tend to find that after 2 hours, people's attention seems to wane quite a bit. So it will be a really good, I think, opportunity for people to get an opportunity to see the requirements of FOI. While you may not be a chairman or a vice chairman, maybe times when you need to step in and do that or running subcommittees, it's going to apply across the board. So I would encourage any board or commission member who may be out there to, if they have the time on next Tuesday, to attend at that meeting.
Open to the public?
we're not going to check IDs on the way in. We do have the downstairs room, so
okay.
We're also exactly. And we have made arrangements with ETV to tape the meeting, and that will be up. So if folks want to watch that afterward, there'll be an opportunity to do that too.
Other written materials?
There may be some handouts on the ethics. Tom is going to hit.
If yes. I won't be there.
Sure.
Thanks.
Yep. Okay.
Anything else, Kevin?
No, that's it.
Any questions for Kevin? Did you notice as people start to lose interest after 2 hours, and we're approaching 1 hour and 35 minutes?
I think that's only when I'm speaking. Mr.
All right. Reports of special committees of the council. Enfield High School Renovation Building Committee. Any report, Donna, Gina? None? Good, Donna?
I guess the only big thing is, I guess for March 1st, they're going to try to get 4 packages out for the bid. So that would be the first bid. That's sort of the acid test. What are the estimates that we've been receiving and juggling with? And I know Matt's looking at me and scowling. But it is. I mean, that is the acid test. We will know, what our destiny is after that. So let's all keep our fingers crossed and hope for really good responses.
Any update on the groundbreaking? Randy sent an email to the town manager, the superintendent, myself, asking for feedback, which I know I responded and the superintendent responded, but nothing back yet.
I think it's the 10th.
Well, I hadn't heard anything. We have a meeting. We do have a meeting on Thursday. I'm hoping that we'll have something by then, because I believe the subcommittee will be meeting prior to our regular meeting.
Yep.
But I did forward them any conflicts that people who got back to me on had.
Okay.
And the majority of them had more conflicts on the 3rd than the 10th.
I think I don't want to speak for the superintendent, but I think the superintendent was pushing for a Friday if you wanted to incorporate students in it. To have it be on a Friday.
Just to let you know, I received an email earlier today from a member of the committee, and what she says here is, based on responses from other liaisons and multiple conflicts on the 3rd, looks like our date is May 10th.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, we did mention to have it during the week, but we got a little pushback on that.
From who?
We suggested several other days as well, but we got a lot of pushback.
We got a lot of pushback.
Okay.
They're going to do what they want to do.
Yeah.
Well, it's under their purview, so, but.
Right, exactly. So we didn't want to be quiet.
Yeah. Okay.
Mr. Mayor.
Maybe that's why I didn't get a response.
Might want to, the May 10th, that's also Mother's Day weekend, so.
Yes, we knew that.
So I be honest with you, I'm not sure how wise that is because of.
We even suggested perhaps later in May.
Yep.
That was not available either.
They may want to think about a weekday, so.
Well, I thought a weekday was also better if we involved the schools, that it just seemed we've always had them on weekdays, that was the preferred.
Okay.
It's still not cast in stone.
Yep. Let us know. All right. Any other reports of special committees of the council? Moving on to old business, appointments town council appointed, items 1 through 9. Is there a motion to remove item 7 from the table?
So moved.
By Councilman Edgar, seconded by Councilman Denny. All those in favor removing the item from the table? Those opposed? Item's been removed. Is there a nomination? Councilman Edgar.
Leroy Nash.
Second.
Motion for Leroy E. Nash, seconded by Councilman Arnone.
Motion to close.
By Deputy Mayor Lee, seconded by?
I'll second it.
By Councilman Denny. All those in favor of closing nominations? Those opposed? Nominations are closed. Any discussion on Leroy Nash for Ethics Commission? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Denny.
4.
Councilman Edgar.
4.
Councilman Hall.
4.
Mayor Copen.
Leroy Nash.
Councilman Lee.
Leroy Nash.
Councilman Stokes.
Leroy Nash.
Councilman Suzak.
4.
Councilman Arnone.
Leroy Nash.
Councilman Bosco.
4.
Councilman Sakala.
Leroy Nash.
There's 10 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
Any other appointments by the council? Any appointments by the town manager? None?
None.
Item C, D remain on the table. Item E, do we have any update on item E? Is there a motion to remove item E from the table by Deputy Mayor Lee, seconded by Councilman Edgar? All those in favor? Those opposed? Item's been removed from the table. Derek?
Thank you. So based on previous discussions, I've got comparative data from both the NLC program, which I explained briefly to you guys in a past meeting. I have more information, or I can answer questions if anybody has any information about that. We've also spoken with Connecticut Water, who offers a similar program. I'd like to preface any discussion by saying that this is, if council decides to take any action, it's for a marketing agreement with one of the companies. That's all this. That said, there's just a few things that I'd like to say. They're fairly similar in price for the residents. Connecticut Water offers three-level program, whereas NLC offers one program. Right now, Connecticut Water obviously does water lines. They're currently reviewing the option to provide a warranty program for sewer lines. The other thing to think about, too, is if we were to move forward with NLC, if council decides to do that, that is simply to do the marketing agreement so that we help them market materials to residents or help market the utility service line warranty program to residents. Council should know that Connecticut Water already does this on their own. They insert the linebacker program pamphlet into their billings. So if we were to do this with Connecticut Water, we would be the first town that they do a marketing agreement with. So that's something else to think about. Some questions that have come up are there any monthly fees, deductibles, caps on service? The fees are, like I said, fairly similar in price in terms of the annual fees. The Connecticut Water does have different levels of per incident caps for paying the warranty, whereas the NLC program has $4,000 per incident, but also offers a sidewalk repair additional allowance. And then if it ever went into the street, they would also offer an additional $4,000. So there's that as well. There is a revenue to the town option. As right now, Connecticut Water just pitches it to their customers, and that's it. If we were to get into a marketing agreement with them, similar to the contract or the agreement with NLC, the NLC agreement calls for a 50-cent per warranty per year revenue option for the town. So the NLC says there's a 30% market share that is pretty typical. So if we went with that number, or we wanted to be super conservative and say they got 10% of the customers or residents, we're looking at a $30,000 to $50,000 a year revenue stream to the town on this program. That would be something that we would obviously try to do similar with Connecticut Water. I mean, that would be our reasoning, one of our reasons for doing this, other than helping market a service to residents if the council decided to do that. Real briefly, that's what it really comes down to. It's do we want a revenue stream? Do we want to provide competition to the utility line warranty program market to residents? Because right now, like I said, Connecticut Water is already doing it. If we agreed to sign the agreement with NLC, then we're allowing NLC to also do it, because they're not just going to do it on their own. We would have to help them market to the town. So that's kind of the brief of it. I just want everybody to understand that it's a marketing agreement that we would be moving forward with. That's it.
Okay. Questions for Derek. Tom.
Just back up a second. You said Connecticut Water doesn't for sewer in this town?
They said that in their own comparison of programs to me, they said that it's currently under review to provide that sort of coverage.
I thought they did
now,
provide that
now,
coverage now.
But that's a sewer only. I'm sorry.
Oh.
Sewer only option. Because NLC has a water only, a sewer only,
right,
or both. I'm sorry.
Right. Okay. So
yes.
Connecticut Water right now, it's
yep,
all or nothing.
And just
you have
to
get both.
Yep. Just to be clear, so there's a linebacker, linebacker plus, and linebacker complete, you know, tier
right,
1, 2, and 3.
Right.
2 and 3 offer the wastewater line.
Right.
Tier 1 does not.
So I have a new wastewater line, so I would be more interested in
yes,
just having a single water
yes,
line one. Okay. Again, the benefits to the town, not only that, are that they cover the sewer line to the street, to the main.
Yep.
So although we're responsible to that curb end to the main, that would also get fixed under this insurance policy, helping us out in the long run.
Well, so the Connecticut Water does service line and then a lot of the internal stuff. They'll do hand valves, meter pits. The Plus and the Complete do all the home plumbing, water lines, internal, external waste lines, whereas the NLC does the service line and the external sewer, including under slabs. That's how they market the program.
Right. So, but to the sewer line, that's the difference, where Connecticut Water is only to the curb. And actually, it's beyond, it's to the sidewalk, to the property line. That's
yeah,
what I understand.
Yeah, yes.
It too. So the NLC covers a longer distance from to the street, which is really ours.
That's my understanding.
Right. Yeah, that's mine too.
Okay.
So far. And then Hazelville Water doesn't provide this.
So
it'll pick up a whole part of town that now does not have that service.
So this was a part of the discussion we had with Connecticut Water because of that very issue. Is the NLC program, if we market it, we market it to all residents. Right now, Connecticut Water provides their little brochure of the linebacker program to their customers. So Matt, correct me if I'm wrong, but there's nothing stopping Connecticut Water from marketing it to the Hazardville residents. They just don't, or Hazardville Water customers, they just don't because they're not their customers. So we asked them to reach out to Hazardville and say, and try to see if they would be willing to work with them. Even if Hazardville Water said no, they could still do it. Just like if we market with, if we did do to NLC, the NLC program, they could do it to both.
So what's staff recommendation? I put you right on the spot.
I would look at it as it's a possible revenue source to the town. If we went with NLC, Connecticut Water is still doing their marketing that they would do anyways.
And the marketing would consist of us dropping a flyer in our bills.
Scott's name probably getting sent on a letter that goes out. I mean, typical stuff that we've done for marketing in the past. I mean, I think there's no harm in showing residents that there's another type of warranty program out there that maybe that'll offset, or not offset, but help provide a better type of service for those who choose Connecticut Water, because now Connecticut Water understands that there's a competition in the market for a warranty program. Maybe that'll drive down costs on a warranty program in terms of an annual fee. These are all speculation, so I can't say that's going to happen. I'm not sure I would recommend, I'm not denouncing the Connecticut Water program, but to market, to sign into a marketing agreement other than for revenue to the town with Connecticut Water might not make as much sense because they're already doing their own marketing.
Right.
And they said that they already gotten 26% of their customer base. If they went in to get the Hazardville, I doubt we would get grandfathered into their former 26%. So that's 26% of a almost 50 cent per warranty fee that we would not be getting. Whereas if NLC came in and somehow managed to get another 25 to 30%, that is a new customer base that the town would receive that 50 cents per warranty. So I mean, really, I'm not trying to dodge it, but it's really up to council if they want to enter into a marketing agreement. That's really all it comes down to.
And I think the insurance is a very important, especially in the older ends of town that have older laterals. This could save people literally thousands of dollars in the long run to have an insurance period, whether they have a choice, which is nice to have a choice, which they didn't have before. And it's, and I'm not selling it, but it is a cheap yearly couple hundred dollars a year. And you know, could save
it's not,
a ton of money.
Not, so not, to correct you, it's not even a couple hundred dollars a year. It's, it's less than a couple hundred dollars a year. It, the max would be $185 for the Connecticut Water Company for their top their tier three plan, and it'd be $152. Now this is a, with the NLC program, it's $152 a year for both water and sewer.
Yes.
So it's just over $100 a year.
It's huge.
And and it's up to a $4,000 per incident with no annual or household cap.
Right.
The one NLC doesn't have a deductible. So I mean, if you want to look at it as, do we want to provide or market a service? Does the town want to market a service to residents? That's up to the council.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
All right, I got Councilman Bosco, then Councilman Denny.
I'm good. He answered my question.
Okay.
Well, first off, I don't think the town should be getting involved in any marketing of anybody's business. At that point there, you know, maybe we can get in a deal with ShopRite, and they'll pay us 50 cents a person so we can steal the work from Stop and Shop. So the town is not in the business of marketing anybody's product. For one. Two, I don't know who NLC, and we asked this, and I never got the question.
I can answer. I know where you're going.
On the contractors.
Yep. You want me to answer that?
Yeah, why don't you answer that?
So I asked that question specifically to both because I knew that was one of your concerns. I was a little less enthused with the way Connecticut Water answered the question. Connecticut Water said, we choose the contractor that we work with. If they happen to be local, then they're local. If we're more comfortable with one that we've used for years that's in a surrounding, that's in the area, that's who we use. NLC has come out in specific, and I'm not advocating for either, but NLC has specifically come out and said that we choose out of the local group first, out of those contractors that meet our standards.
Now, how far is local? They're talking
for the town? Out of the town. I asked that. Are you talking about the town of Enfield, or are you talking about the region? And NLC said the town of Enfield contractors who meet the safety, you know, the general contractor standards and the plumbing standards, those are the, there's a pool that they would choose from first. So you're getting the NLC seems to gear itself more towards the town. And I know that's where the concern.
Well, the only thing is I know that Connecticut Water uses a few companies from town to do their work.
Right.
You know, so I wouldn't want to steal work from our own contractors, but with that said, ultimately the town should not be partnering with any business. I mean, at that point there, you know, Connecticut Water pays taxes with their on their water fields or something, whatever, I'm sure, on their equipment. Hazardville Water does. You know, we're robbing from our own tax base to give it to somebody else. And the town should not be in business of sending anything anywhere, and I would strongly oppose it no matter what. Thank you.
Thank you, Joey. Tom?
Yeah. Quickly, who NLC? Explain who NLC is. And this is another thing about regional buying power and using our organizations to, you know, National League of Cities or CCM. That's why we join these, is to use that regionalization, that power of buying. And it's a great idea when we can do that. But please do. We tell them what they are, who they are.
I was just going to say yes, because
it
sounded like you.
Yeah, well, it's not a business. It's the League of Cities.
Yeah, so, all right. So I, if you're not aware, the state has its Connecticut Conference of Municipalities and the Connecticut Council of Small Towns. You know, those are our town organizations that advocate and work to support municipalities. At the national level, you have other organizations. One of the biggest ones is the National League of Cities, so that's NLC. NLC is the one that has did the work to bid out for which company do they want to now work with to provide this service line warranty program, and they choose Utility Service Partners. So they used their means to find the best person that, or the best group that they thought could provide this service to the towns and cities of the country, and now it's up to each town and city to determine if it's what works best for them. Does that answer the question?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. And now for the rebuttal, Councilman Bosco.
Just trust me, the government's never your friend.
Hey, Joe, you are the government. Sorry.
I may be the government, but I am probably one of the most persons that will go against the government to stand up for the people that are that elected me. I never, ever back down to a fight from the town against the people in this town. So the residents of the town always come first.
Greatest government in the world.
Okay, any further questions or comments for Derek?
Yeah, Obama.
That's right. Okay, so this is going to slide to the next agenda.
Motion to retable.
By Councilman Edgar, seconded by?
Second.
To retable by Councilman Denny. All those in favor of the retable? By show of hands, those opposed? Unanimous.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, I counted you. Retabled. Okay. That completes old business. We move to new business. There's no consent agenda. We have appointments by the council. We have four for Prison Town Liaison Committee. Is there a motion for item three?
So moved.
No, you got to put the person's name in.
Kenneth Edgar.
Second. So nomination for Kenneth Edgar, seconded by Councilman Arnone. By Councilman Hall, seconded by Councilman Denny. All those in favor of closing nominations? Those opposed? Nominations are closed. Any discussion? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Denny.
Four.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Councilman Hall.
Four.
Mayor Copen.
Kenneth Edgar.
Deputy Mayor Lee.
Kenneth Edgar.
Councilman Stokes.
Kenneth Edgar.
Councilman Suzak.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Kenneth Edgar.
Councilman Bosco.
Four.
Councilman Sakala.
Kenneth Edgar.
There's 10 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
Item four, is there a nomination?
Tofi.
Go ahead, Bill.
Oh, I'd like to nominate Tofi Nowak to the Prison Liaison Committee.
Second.
Motion by Deputy Mayor Lee, seconded by Councilman Edgar. Is there a motion to close nominations? Motion. By Councilman Hall, seconded by Councilman Denny. All those in favor of closing nominations, by a show of hands. Those opposed, nominations are closed. Discussion? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Denny.
Four.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Councilman Hall.
Tofi Nowak.
Mayor Copen.
Tofi Nowak.
Deputy Mayor Lee.
Tofi Nowak.
Councilman Stokes.
Tofi Nowak.
Councilman Suzak.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Tofi Nowak.
Councilman Bosco.
Four.
Councilman Sakala.
Tofi Nowak.
There's 10 in favor, and against, no abstentions.
Item five, is there a nomination?
Hang on 1 second.
No. Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
I'd like to nominate.
Go ahead, Tom.
Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
Motion for Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall, seconded by Councilman Hall. Is there a motion to close nominations? By Councilman Denny, seconded by Councilman Suzak. All those in favor of closing nominations, those opposed. Nominations are closed. Discussion? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Denny.
Four.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Councilman Hall.
Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
Mayor Copen.
Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
Deputy Mayor Lee.
Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
Councilman Stokes.
Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
Councilman Suzak.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
Councilman Bosco.
Four.
Councilman Sakala.
Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
There's 10 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
And item six, is there a nomination? Councilman Sakala.
I'd like to nominate Nelson Rodriguez, please.
Motion by Councilman Sakala, seconded by Councilman Edgar. Is there a motion to close nominations?
So moved.
By Deputy Mayor Lee, seconded by Councilman Denny. All those in favor of closing nominations, those opposed. Nominations are closed. Any discussion? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Denny.
Nelson Rodriguez.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Councilman Hall.
Nelson Rodriguez.
Mayor Copen.
Nelson Rodriguez.
Deputy Mayor Lee.
Nelson Rodriguez.
Councilman Stokes.
Nelson Rodriguez.
Councilman Suzak.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Nelson Rodriguez.
Councilman Bosco.
Four.
Councilman Sakala.
Nelson Rodriguez.
There's 10 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
Mm-hmm. And can we have a motion to remove item 7 from the agenda?
So moved.
By Deputy Mayor Lee, seconded by Councilman Denny. All those in any discussion? This is just, it's being handled under items for discussion. Any reappointment or any filling of a vacancy on the Pearl Street Library Centennial Anniversary Committee requires a resolution, not an appointment. So, okay, by a show of hands, all those in favor removing the item from the agenda. Those opposed. Unanimous, item's been removed from the agenda. No appointments by the manager, item C, so we move to items for discussion. All items have been moved to miscellaneous. So we move to miscellaneous. The first is I would need a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
By Councilman Stokes, seconded by Councilman Edgar. By a show of hands, all those in favor of approving the consent agenda. Those opposed, unanimous. Appointments, town council appointed. Item 1, prison town liaison committee. Is there a nomination?
Like to nominate Carmela Brennan.
Second.
Motion by Deputy Mayor Lee, seconded by Councilman Edgar. Is there a motion to close nominations? By Councilman Hall, seconded by Councilman Suzak. All those in favor of closing nominations? Those opposed? Nominations are closed. Discussion? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Denny.
Four.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Councilman Hall.
Carmela Brennan.
Mayor Copan.
Carmela Brennan.
Deputy Mayor Lee.
Carmela Brennan.
Councilman Stokes.
Carmela Brennan.
Councilman Suzak.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Carmela Brennan.
Councilman Bosco.
Four.
Councilman Sakala.
Carmela Brennan.
There's 10 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
Next item, discussion resolution, request for transfer of funds for Public Works road salt purchase, $70,000. Resolved that in accordance with Chapter 6, Section 8F of the Town Charter, the following transfers hereby made. From appropriated fund balance, $55,000, and other professional services, $15,000. To maintenance building supplies, $70,000. Certified the funds are available. Lynn Nenny, Director of Finance. Is there a motion?
Motion.
Motion by Councilman Sakala, seconded by Councilman Arnone. Hello, Jonathan.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Do you want me to talk to the motion?
You can talk to the motion, but also the questions that were sent to the manager on our budget or your budget. How do you like dealing with, what's it? 7 storms in 16 days? You don't look worse for the, you know, you don't really look all that bad. Not too tired.
Why don't you start with this information first?
Okay.
So what was just passed around was a worksheet that we use internally. It's a work in progress. It's something that Clayton Northgraves, the business manager, and I are revamping, and it is the highway division snow costs. And it's important to note that one of our goals is to prepare a consolidated snow worksheet that would include the costs from all the other divisions, which are not insignificant. But this is the numbers that the council has been looking at that are called out as a special snow operations. For example, we have a budget of $90,000 for contractors. That's in the highway division. And in fact, this year, I don't think any of the other divisions have used contractors. So that is a true contractor's cost for helping with snow. The overtime is not, because there is overtime being incurred in the other divisions for their snow operations. For example, water pollution control, you know, removes snow at their pump and lift stations in the plant. Sometimes that work is on overtime. Building and grounds, of course, is doing most of Thompsonville. they need to work overtime on those snow operations, but that's not included here. As an example, we had to delay refuse and recycling pickup last week because of the storm. They ended up coming in on Saturday. Those costs are in that budget, but they're directly related to the snow. So anyway, next year our goal is to put all that on one page and give your true total DPW cost for snow. Anyway, this is the highway division only. And I guess the question was on the contractor and payroll. This is a work in progress. I was reviewing this late this afternoon. For example, doesn't have the, this only goes to the 14th. So there's, we're still collecting the information from today's storm and Saturdays are not on here. So again, it takes a little bit of time to pull all the data together. It's not 100% up to date, but you can see where we were on the highway overtime versus the snow budget for highway overtime and the contractor's costs. And again, those numbers are out of date already because of the Saturday storm. And today they actually were working past quitting time, finishing up the road. So this is the information we had as of the 14th. So the request is for the an additional appropriation for salt, untreated salt. And there's been a long story and a lot written about it. All the newspapers have reported on it. The governor had a press release last week about how the state's going to help us and so on. All of that has really not generated any new salt in the area. There's been a lot of emails, a lot of phone calls, and a lot of hoopla, which has really given minimal results. So, salt is trickling in. A load at a time. We make call after call, and we get like two loads of salt. So, for example, we placed an order on February 5th for 400 tons of salt, and so far we've gotten 120. That's 2 weeks later. Many, many phone calls, press conferences, et cetera, et cetera. It's just not here. It's not in the state, and DOT doesn't want to give up all their salt. They need it for the highways. They have a certain amount of supply. So everyone's waiting for the next barge or however it's coming in to come in. Interesting, we're getting all kinds of solicitations. This one I got yesterday. I'm not even going to give the company. I read in The Current on Sunday, Enfield is having issues with salt availability. We have a source in Utah that can supply you. It's $45 a ton plus freight if you have access to a rail spur. Please call me. That was some company that, they're reading the newspapers and we're getting all this unsolicited. Yes, yes. Well, I don't think we want to use that rail line for untreated road salt. We want to move people. So,
right.
Anyway, that is the request here is to provide the additional funds so that we can purchase another 1,000 tons of untreated road salt. As I said in my memo, the unit price jumped dramatically earlier this month, but it's still not available. But if it becomes available, we want to be in a position to make an order and get it in here as soon as possible, as we've exhausted that budget right now. So that's the request, is to appropriate the additional funds so we're in a position to place that order and get whatever salt we can.
Okay, questions on road salt? Ed?
Actually, it's really not a shortage that everybody's talking about. It's really a transportation problem with the salt, correct? That's all I
have. I believe so.
We're not out of salt.
Well, it has to do with the state canceling the contract as well, right? And then having to find another one. So do you want to go through, for our listeners at home, a little history on
Okay,
why we're really in this shortage?
Well, I can't say for sure, and I think there's going to be investigations as to why there's a shortage, and I'm not in a position right now to exactly say whether there's something else going on than what meets the eye. But there was the company that the Department of Administrative Services had contracted with, that Enfield was participating in that contract. The state terminated the contract on January 24th. We were not having any problems with the company. They were making our deliveries. We were satisfied, but apparently there were other communities or state agencies that they were not satisfying the contract, so the state terminated the contract on January 24th and then had a fire drill to get another contractor lined up, which they did. They entered into a contract with another company at a price increase of 30%, which is not insignificant. That's a lot of money. And since they lined up this other contractor, you know, well, we haven't been getting, like I said, dribs and drabs. We've gotten, I think, 6 loads of salt. We placed an order for 400 tons. That was all the money we had in the budget, and we've gotten 120 in a matter of a couple weeks. There's supposedly 2 more loads coming this week. The state's claiming we might be able to recover the incremental cost of the road salt down the road, but we can't buy it right now, so there's not much incremental cost to recover. And like I said, there's various things going on. They sent around a spreadsheet of 3, 6, 9, about 12 other companies all across the country, ranging from Nebraska to Morton Salt to, I don't know where all these places are, Kansas, Arkansas. You know, you just can't call out of the blue and say, we're Enfield, we need 300 tons, ship it to us from Arkansas. It's just not going to happen. I mean, road salt's a commodity, and there's bulk purchasing, and hopefully we'll, have a good contract again. But we and many, many others are being left high and dry. I mean, just watch the news every night. We're making it stretch as far as we can by mixing it with sand. So instead of putting straight salt, untreated salt in the road, which is what we would like to do, we're mixing it with 2 parts sand, 1 part salt. And it's, it's not melting the snow on the road the way true salt would do. And so that's why many of the roads are still snow covered, especially in the lower traveled areas. And that's, you look at almost most towns, that's the situation they're in.
All set, Tom?
Yep, just quick. Thank you for getting this spreadsheet out to us. We're worried that we're going to go over quite a bit in excess of the salt, because we knew the salt was going to cost us anyway, and doing a great job managing what little you have. I know we've gone away from the sand for over the years, and now we have it back on the roads again, which will give us a springtime problem of having to clean our catch basins and getting out and doing that again, which we avoided with just straight salt. So it'll be more cost to this whole problem. So thank you for getting this out, and it still looks like we're managing. It's still close, if not over. So
the overtime budgets are
busted.
Yeah, I mean, we'll be over. Guarantee it, because we need to do some overtime work in the spring. The highway department's going to need to do some overtime work. I mean, there's overtime coming in the last part. Building and grounds, doing ball fields, they need to do that, some overtime. I mean, there's overtime that's part of the system. So those budgets will be over if they're not right now. They're going to have to be.
And these overtime budgets in this year, too, and these 2 storms were exacerbated by the long length of them, 36 hours. Some of these were longer. They weren't short, quick storms, so you're working more overtime over a longer period of time because they were back-to-backers. Is that correct?
That's correct. There's also been over 20 storms that we've cataloged on this sheet that have required some overtime. That's a lot. I mean, I was looking back at some other previous years. Some were less than 10.
10, yeah.
And I don't remember what last year's was. So, yes, the number of storms that have required after-hours work is unusual, and a lot of those have been salt-treating storms. It's been an inch, or it melted during the day and then froze at night, and it wasn't necessarily snow, but we need to go out and treat the roads, and we did. So that also used up a lot more salt. And what the comment on the intersections, I agree that there are many intersections that are very high. But going into the last larger storm last week, I think it was a 7 to 10 inch prediction. But what I told people internally was that it's not a 10 inch storm, because the 10 inches that had fallen the week before hadn't melted because of the cold temperature. So we were starting with a 10-inch base. So 10 plus 10, it was like we're getting a 20-inch snowfall. That's a lot of snow. That's going to cause a lot of issues. And now, since then, we've had two more snowfalls. Today was 6.5 inches. And I can't remember what it was, Saturday, another 4 or 5 inches. So, you know, you're building up. It hasn't melted. We're up to like a 30-inch snowfall. That's why the intersections are high, and we need to get knocking them down. And there's just a lot of areas in town that need additional attention. It was because the snow has been building. So we're looking forward to some warmer temperatures, some melting before the next cold front moves through next week.
No, again, thank you.
Councilman Bosco.
I like this, but when we get all done with the winter and we're complaining about the heat, can we get this whole thing complete, including the money we spent widening streets and pushing banks over so you can see? And so we have a total cost of what the winter was. And can we go to the contractor that's stuck with all these tons of salt and just buy it from them? The one that the state won't do business with anymore?
We have contacted them, and that was the first thing we did because their price was better and we didn't have any issue. And
well, I'm sure he has a surplus, too.
We contacted him multiple times. He ended up not having any salt for us or for anybody. I don't know what happened there.
I guess it's probably an I show you moment.
Shipped it to Massachusetts.
Thank you.
Councilman Stokes.
You mentioned something that kind of got my ears up there about there may be an investigation. I mean, just clarify, investigation in what agency or something like that in the state? And the reason I'm asking that is that should we, if there is going to be some type of investigation, should we be keeping records of the additional costs that we've incurred because of the firing of the contract and then redoing this at a 30%. I mean, should we be keeping records so if there is some
sand?
I mean, I'm thinking that to get our ducks in order in case there is some money to be recovered because of something like this, it might be wise enough to be able to do that, just thinking. So, I mean, what was the investigation?
I just remember one of the senators indicated they were going to start an investigation.
Okay. I mean, I'm just saying we might want to keep a kind of running figure in case there's something to recoup or whatever, or they might ask if anybody had harm. And, you know, obviously we're having harm. So, and I just want to thank, knowing all this, please put out the word to all the drivers and the staff working with not the best resources, doing a great job. And so we appreciate it. So, and we're passing on to the public that we have an adjustment of what we're putting down, which means snow is not going to melt as fast as it used to. So, thank you.
Thanks, Greg. Councilman Hall.
Jonathan, just a question. I know years ago when we used to get a lot more of these storms, similar storms, we used to go and physically take dump trucks to get rid of these mountains of snow. I mean, is that something that I don't honestly want to see us wait for the snow to melt at the intersections. I would hope that we're going to make an effort to move along, and whether it means bringing in dump trucks to take the snow out, I don't know what it takes, but I don't want to wait for Mother Nature to melt these mountains of snow for us for safety reasons. So just can you talk to that?
Well, we started that already on Saturday. We were knocking down some intersections and moving some snow out of downtown with our dump trucks. And then, you know, we're talking about bringing in one outside contractor, a large dump truck with our snowblower to supplement our fleet to do more of that and attend to more intersections over the next few days. The problem in getting to it is that we just get done cleaning the streets from the storm, and then the next one came. I mean, that's how it's been the last 2 weeks. There hasn't really been time to catch your breath and say, okay, let's go clean up. But we're hoping to do that in the next 3 or 4 days, really make a dent in the area, in intersections and downtown.
Okay.
Cul-de-sacs.
It seems like it's mostly coming out onto the main arteries that seem to be the big issues, you know. So any of the cut-through streets where all the subdivisions empty out on are issues. So thank you.
Thanks, Carol. Deputy Mayor Lee?
I'm sure it's been part of your discussion, but can you just let us know whether there is a better opportunity to dispatch vehicles to go acquire material where it's stockpiled rather than waiting for the delivery schedule of the vendor?
Well, we've pursued every avenue.
Okay.
And we, after the governor's press release, there were two components to the plan that the state offered. One was call us up if you're on the state contract, which we were, and, you know, tell us what you need, which we did, mm-hmm. and we got two loads of salt from that. The second part of it was, if you're not on the state contract, call us up and we'll give you some salt from our stockpile. So we did that also, and we said, well, we'll drive a truck to East Windsor and get some salt. And then we were told, no, that's not for you because you're on the state contract. We don't have any to give you. We're just giving out a load or two here and there. So we did offer to go to East Windsor with our vehicles and get salt. Didn't happen.
But the yards where the production, I mean, looking here, it's International Salt. I mean, looks like their production facilities are in Pennsylvania or Quebec. I mean, is there anything that the municipality would entertain to hire some trucks to go grab this stuff at the production yard and bring it back? And maybe we're not at that critical point, but I'm guessing one more storm and we might be.
We're okay for a couple more storms with the mixture. I went out this afternoon with the highway superintendent. We looked into the shed and did some rough estimates of what's in there. And we have enough material right now for a couple more storms. If we get two more loads of salt tomorrow and we get some more sand, we'll mix that up, and you know, we're gonna stretch it out. Hopefully, you know, we're gonna keep.
Are we getting sand on a regular basis?
Sand we haven't been having a problem
with. So that's still our backup and it's readily available.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Councilman Suzak?
I just have a question, like looking to the future. How much do we stockpile during the summer?
Well, Billy Taylor, who's got a lot of experience in salt sheds, we have 5,000 tons of capacity.
Okay.
And I've only been here a couple years, so we haven't tried to fill up the shed in the summer, although some communities, that is their strategy, to go fill up whatever salt shed they have in the summer and not rely on replenishment during the winter. I don't think that's been the strategy here per se, but it's something we may want to look at.
Right, because it might be cheaper in the summer, you know, some buying in the off season,
right,
so to speak.
It's a lot of money to fill up the salt shed. We're talking.
Well, it is, but
$250,000 dollars and up. It's not something you just do.
Any further questions for Jonathan? Ed?
I want to say that you guys are doing a great job, but I've had calls from people, and I guess the question I have is there a procedure of how you would do residential areas? Do you just plow? Let me tell you what the complaint is about.
The complaint is about that you're going from one, you're doing one side and then the other, and some of the people in my own neighborhood are complaining that you're dumping more snow on one side of the street than the other. And the question that someone asked me is there a procedure to do that? Do you do one pass in the middle and then separate it, or you're just doing one side and the other? Is a simple question. And don't get me wrong, I'm not throwing stones, because I think you guys are doing a great job with this winter.
I think it depends on the driver and the route. I mean, I heard in one particular case, a contractor who was going to do a certain neighborhood, and we tell him, well, whatever side you did, you know, first, the last time, reverse it. So people don't, like you said, oh, they're always dumping, you know, two-thirds of the snow on my side versus one-third. So is that formulaic, and does everyone do it that way? I couldn't tell you off the top of my head. I mean, we'd have to go look at the certain streets, and if there is a complaint that one side of the street is always getting more than 50% of the snow, well, then they can reverse it, and the other people will then call you the next day that they got more than 50%. So, yeah.
Ed, they actually, they know what street you live on, so they do two-thirds of the street onto your side.
They used to do that to me.
To your neighbors.
I kind of like, my own attitude is that.
Push it right in the yard.
Once the plows come by, even if you do your driveway, you're going to do it again anyway. So if it's half a foot or a foot that they throw there, what's the difference? You use the snow blower and you get it out of there. I mean, that's my attitude. But people are calling in today, and, you know, we're always, you know, it's another foot and a half, you know, to get there.
Yeah. Gina.
Just to follow up on Ed's questions, we were getting questions about that, so we sort of wanted to know if there was a policy, and we were told there was a policy on how the plows, the drivers are either trained or if there is a policy in your department. So if there is supposed to be a training specific to each of the drivers, or if there's something that's specific to a road, like you had indicated, it's good to know, so at least we can tell the residents who are complaining to us. But if there really isn't a procedure and it really depends on the driver, then...
I haven't seen anything written down.
Well, there is a snow policy for plowing.
Right, but
I have it in my office. I see it.
But I don't know if it says...
Yeah, it doesn't get that. I mean,
1 week you go this way, the next week you go the other.
Granular was, do you have... A written policy.
Okay, well, that's good to know. So there is a plowing procedure, just might not be a training procedure to. Okay. Right. Yeah. Good to know.
And I guess that's going to be pretty difficult, because you have contractors that are working for you too, correct?
Yes, sir.
So
what they, I mean, we're supposed to be watching them. If they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing, we're correct it. So that's not an excuse to say that we. Just a little more administrative oversight we need to do.
Anyone else? So I have two questions. One, power of technology, and a resident. As we're pushing back these banks or removing snow, are we avoiding refilling sidewalks?
That's the goal.
So the goal is if they're cutting an intersection back, we're not plopping the snow onto a sidewalk for then a resident or a business to have to clear again.
Correct. That would be, if we're doing that, we're not supposed to be doing that.
Right. Okay. Ideally, but at least they're not there taking the bank and just pushing the bank onto a, you know, onto a sidewalk.
Yeah, and just right. To address that, that's something that would occur during a large snowfall, just to manage it early on. But what they're doing now is on the cleanup side, so it's less likely for that to happen.
Right.
So that's why I think it's important to understand the differences between the time frame that we do the things that we do.
Right. And then on the policy or the procedure for plowing, isn't that more of that the mains are done, followed by the secondaries, followed by the neighborhood, the dead-end streets.
Correct.
Right. And so they're always, because everyone will complain, hey, how come my street's not plowed, but right. Green Manor Road is plowed? Well, that's a main going into a neighborhood, and that gets done first. And then, right, so, and that might be,
that's 'cause you're on the council.
It might be helpful to, when in the downtime of, you know, colorize a map saying, here's your mains. I don't know if it's main, secondary, and tertiary or whatever. But, yeah. Anything else for Jonathan? All right. Any other questions on the salt transfer?
Spice of life.
Sensing none. Roll call, please.
Councilman Denny.
Four.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Councilman Hall.
Four.
Mayor Copen.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Lee.
Four.
Councilman Stokes.
Four.
Councilman Suzak.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Four.
Councilman Bosco.
Four.
Councilman Sakala.
Four.
There's 10 in favor, none against, no.
All right, next item is discussion resolution appointing Robert Sweeney to the Pearl Street Branch Library Centennial Anniversary Committee.
So moved.
Hold on, I got to read the resolution. Whereas the Enfield Town Council at its July 1st, 2013 regular meeting authorized the formation of the Pearl Street Branch Library Centennial Anniversary Committee, which consists of five Enfield residents. And whereas the council appointed Director of Libraries Henry Dutcher as a committee staff liaison and charged him with the task of providing to the council a recommendation regarding the committee membership. And whereas the council at its August 5th, 2013 regular meeting appointed Judith Aparizzi DeRoche, Timothy Jensen, Yvonne Wallenberg, Roberta Richmond, and Denise Barnes to the committee. And whereas Ms. Aparizzi DeRoche will not be able to complete her term on the committee, now therefore be it resolved that the council does appoint Robert Sweeney to the committee to serve the remainder of Ms. Aparizzi DeRoche's term.
So moved.
By Councilman Edgar, seconded by Councilman Stokes. Discussion?
Scott. Then,
go ahead, Bill.
Just in case, is it appropriate here to just add an amendment to any future vacancies can be made by simple appointment by the council? Does it matter?
It's really six of one, half dozen of another. I mean, whether it goes on there as that or a resolution.
Okay, withdrawn.
Further discussion? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Denny.
Four.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Councilman Hall.
Four.
Mayor Copen.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Lee.
Four.
Councilman Stokes.
Four.
Councilman Suzak.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Four.
Councilman Bosco.
Four.
Councilman Sakala.
Four.
There's 10 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
Okay. And our final item, discussion resolution for the adoption of the revised ETV station manager job description. Resolution for the adoption of the revised ETV station manager job description in the library department. Resolved that in accordance with Chapter 7, Section 2 of the Town Charter, the Enfield Town Council does hereby adopt the following revised job description for the position of ETV station manager. Is there a motion to approve?
Motion.
By Councilman Hall, seconded by Councilman Stokes. Discussion. Do you want to run over this, Matt?
Yes. So once Kevin Sullivan left us, HR department and library director put out a request for people to submit resumes using what was created, I think it was 2 years ago when Kevin was appointed to this position. So effectively what the position description reflected was the qualities of the person that was going to be going into that position at that point in time. And just to kind of clarify that, Kevin was basically doing that job before, and we just wanted to formalize what that was to make sure that, again, going forward, we would be able to achieve the goals where we have a person doing the job and working within a certain classification. So when we put it back out, we received a number of resumes from individuals, and they first started looking at those that met the qualifications currently that council adopted. So they have to have had a four-year degree. And what we found was the candidates that had the four-year degree didn't have a lot of experience on the video and video production end. When they looked at those individuals that didn't have the four-year degree, they had a two-year degree plus experience. They all had a lot more qualifications than what the four-year degrees were. They actually interviewed, I think, three candidates that had a four-year degree. Didn't feel that those individuals would meet the needs of the station. They then interviewed those candidates that only had a two-year degree but a considerable amount of work experience towards that, and they felt that those were better candidates. And so they wanted to come forward to change the position description. And in this case, all we're doing is adding or an equivalent combination of education and experience.
Okay, discussion. Joey.
I'm going to support this, but I don't like, we're doing this more and more and more. And when we do these job classifications, I think we should really start thinking about it. It just, there was a reason why we write everyone a certain way. And just because we can't find the caliber of people that we expect doesn't mean that they're not out there. It just means we may have to be looking a little more. And I just get a little nervous now that we keep changing. We've done it for multiple positions. So, you know, there was a reason why we asked for a four-year college degree. And, you know, I understand what you're saying, and I have no problem with it, but I'm more or less commenting for future stuff because we keep changing our requirements and we're bringing them down. We're not going up. So I just think we're going on a slippery road, but I will support this one.
If I could just address, especially in this one in particular, when you look at the field, and I don't think that we did a good job of looking at the field 2 years ago when this was created, because I think we were short-sighted because we had somebody on staff that had already been doing a lot of the work, and the thought was, well, this is what we need. But when you look at the field in the video production that we're looking at, it really is more of a two-year degree field today than it is a four-year. And so I think, you know, I hear what you're saying, and I don't advocate going wholesale changing, but there are times when we're dealing with position descriptions that were written 20 years ago that don't take into account today's, you know, requirements and needs. So I think there are those times when it is necessary to do it, and I would hope we're not just doing it willy-nilly now, just change for change's sake. I think there is more thought going into what are the needs and what is the area or the requirements that are going to give us the largest pool of applicants, not only in current position hirings, but also in the future.
Well, I agree. I mean, there's no substitute for experience either. You know, you can have the best education. If you never did it, it's not going to help you at all. We have seen that with other employees we had. But, you know, that's why I'm saying I'll agree with it, but I just think that, you know, we got to start looking at everyone we're doing because we can't be just keep dropping standards to get employees.
Thanks, Joey. I have Councilman Edgar, then Councilman Stokes, then Councilman Arnone Sakala.
Well, it was advertised as a four-year degree. Now we're going to take somebody with a two. There may be a lot of people out there that fell under the two-year requirement, and they're not being given a chance. I think it's wrong to take a two where you had a four, and I believe it should go back and be advertised all over again for 2 year to give them other people a chance. And I cannot support this.
Okay,
Councilman Stokes?
I just have some experiences because I have a lot of folks that work with me and for me that could we do television production, editing, and stuff. And I can tell you right now that I think this is good because of the fact that, even to be honest with you, some of the most talented people don't have the degrees in this. They actually are just creative like they can be, and we have multi-cameras and stuff, and we do our editing and stuff. And by the time, and I think, Scott, you've been to some of the stuff that we've done, by the time we're done, you couldn't tell if it was done by a four-year master's or the four or five people that put it together. So I think this is great because I think a lot of these kind of positions here, I almost want to say there's a lot of techies out there that didn't get almost the formal training that can go worlds around some others. So I like this. So.
Thanks, Greg. Councilman Arnone.
What's the salary range?
I believe this is $44,000.
Starts at $44,000?
Correct.
Now, I keep telling my kids all the time, you ain't going to go nowhere without a four-year degree. So here I am. I'm going to sit here and hope you're not listening, kids. Joe, I'm with you on this one.
Well, if I could say.
Please.
To help you with your children, the issues that we have is that for $44,000, you don't attract people that have four-year degrees and a lot of experience. They're making already a lot more money than that. And so I think that's the situation that communities like ourselves that are trying to stay within budget, and run a top-notch organization, but not pay, give me $80,000, and I could probably get you somebody with a master's degree in this and 10 years experience. But the reality is we have $44,000. So to your children, get the four-year degree because you get paid a lot more. So,
right. Thank you, Matt. I'm going to record that.
Motivational speech.
Right. Councilman Sakala.
I just had a couple of questions. When was this posted? How long was it posted for, if that's an easier question to answer?
Well, I would hate to comment on something I don't know for sure. I believe it was before the first of this year was when it was posted. Mm-hmm. Typically, we do 3 weeks of posting, but again, I can't speak specifically to this one.
And how many applicants were there? How many people applied?
Again, I couldn't tell you exactly what that number was.
And how do you have any idea how many were interviewed?
I want to say there were three that had four-year degrees. Mm-hmm. I think there were three, maybe four, that did not.
See, I would really want to know how many people applied, because if we got 50 applications, then I'd be shocked if not one person with a four-year degree would be good for the job. And another comment going along with what Red touched upon, if you're going to change the description, it should probably be reposted.
And if council wants us to do that, we'll post it tomorrow.
And last comment, if we are changing the description to not require a four-year degree, are you going to be lowering the salary?
No, was not planning on that.
Okay, then I don't know that I can support this as is.
So Bill pulled up the first posting and it's dated June 3rd.
Yeah, that's what you just said.
So that's when the job, it went out the first time. So, all right, any further discussion? Ed?
Yes. I would be willing to support this if you would repost it. That's my comment.
Willing to do that. It's just time is all it is.
Yeah. Councilman Suzak?
I guess what I'm hearing from you, Matt, is the $44,000 is more commensurate with a two-year degree. So that's why you're not changing the salary. Okay.
I think for experience and education, we tried to put the number in a number that worked for our budget, that didn't, because I know early on we were talking that should be in the 60s.
Correct.
And we just didn't feel that that type of commitment for the station at this point in time made a lot of sense. And so, again, we had an internal staff member that was, had a lot of the things we were looking for, had a four-year, actually was working on his master's, that salary range worked for that person. So, yes, I think that that is something that works for the budget. And let me just say this, that one thing, and, you know, all of the department directors know this about me, is we do not fill jobs to get a body in there. We fill jobs to do the best job for us. And so when we hire people, it's to get the best. Now, I'm not saying it works all the time, but that is what the goal is. And if we didn't have people that we felt could do the job, this would have been reposted, you know, again. But I think, you know, we're looking at it saying we feel that we have some people that will do a tremendous job for us in the group that we, you know, received. And again, that's, you know, what we try to do is fill them quickly, but fill them with very good people, not just to fill them with bodies, because that does not work for us.
Thanks. Further discussion? Just for my two cents, I'm comfortable with the change in the job description. You know, ETV for us is such an important resource, and to continue to delay it, you know, if the manager was coming back saying, we don't have qualified candidates, we've got to repost it, then I would be looking at. But they have a very strong candidate that they've identified through the process. And people are applying for positions all over the place. And they're not necessarily looking at, what we're doing is what private business is doing. You may set a standard, but it's that relevant job experience that's there. It's that interview, that one-on-one that you have with the individual to make sure, like Joey said, I mean, you can have all the education you want in the world, but do you know how to do the job? And so I see this as they found someone, and maybe we're writing job descriptions too strictly, and that we're handicapping ourselves when we write these job descriptions. And that might be something for our charter to look at. Charter Revision Commission is, you know, are we putting ourselves in a difficult position to have to request changes for things? I'm comfortable with the conversation that we had in leadership over how you've come up with the leading candidate and what skills he brings to the position. I think it would be a shame for us to pass it by, and hopefully the person has a long career here. If not, we may have to revise it again, Tom.
So we have a candidate. So you're saying, you know, we're just having a conversation here about reposting this, and you have somebody. I'm confused.
Well, I don't have anybody. It's been recommended that there is a candidate that would be very, very good for the organization in that position. But again, you know, I understand that if you feel that that's what should be done, we will do that. Now, that may mean that we don't get that candidate, you know, when all this is said and done, we'll get a better person possibly. But again, you know, I don't want to lose the forest for the trees here. I mean, if we don't change this, we definitely will be reposting a four-year position. We're going to be back in the same position we are. And again, we will not fill this position with somebody that I do not believe will be able to do the job. So, you know, again, based upon the first time we posted it, what we received, we did not get people that I felt could do the job that we expect. And so I can't guarantee that when we repost it again, because that's what we'll do if we don't change it, that we'll get any better candidates or any worse candidates. We may end up having to repost it again. I'm just not going to fill it.
And two, what the public probably doesn't know, since we've lost Kevin, it's tough. He was very good at what he did. If I give him a video, he can run the video up for me, and he can, you know, get everything we need up here that we don't technically have at our fingertips. We do need that person that is in control of the station.
Yeah,
so
I'm
not debating that.
We've kind of shut down
our
operations to a certain degree. I mean, you know, Kevin gave us a lot of capability to do advanced programming. You know, now, again, I don't mean to be disparaging about the people we have, but that's not what their job is, to do that advanced type of programming. And so they keep, you know, programs like this going. But, you know, in terms of our ability.
Yes, and thank you on the booth. I didn't mean to anything personal, folks, but yeah, it is important to have that lead.
Yeah.
To have that lead. I'll never get the camera again. See?
And what you have to understand about our operations, you know, the individuals that are manning the booth today and other times, you know, they are part-time individuals. And we have a budget for part-time individuals, and that budget does not allow for us to use them to do a lot of the things that the station manager, and it really is a misnomer. I mean, it's a title is what it is to help make up for the lack of pay that's on this, that we know that we're going to get a certain type of person that probably is not going to be here a long time. I mean, that's just the reality of the hiring process, and even the candidates that we looked at for 4 year that have a 4 year degree probably are not, I mean, you know, their background were mainly in library science type of backgrounds. And what we learned with Kevin, you know, God bless Kevin, he was, you know, wanted to be a director of library services somewhere. That was what it, not to be a station manager. And so, you know, he was, you know, to his credit, constantly improving himself. He got his master's, started looking around, and got, you know, a job that fit in his career path. And so, you know, we lose a lot of capability when we don't have somebody here 8 hours a day doing that job.
One last quick thing, and that's, you know, we're in the this is under the director of libraries, and, mm-hmm. and we seem to be getting pools for people that are into library media, yep. not necessarily TV media. Right. And I don't know, maybe that has to be looked at. And that's it. Thank
yeah,
you.
And just to let you know, I mean, you know, we, going back to day one, you know, ETV in day one was out of the town manager's office. I didn't see that as a stable way to grow the programming. Our library director had background in other services where he operated, you know, PEG stations. And so he had the broadest, you know, vision of what these systems could be. And so that's why it became a natural fit to put that service within his operations. He understands as well as I understand that doesn't mean that, you know, 10 years from now, that's where it's going to be. It is growing. It is really becoming a function of our communication program more so than it is of the library program. And so, you know, the evolution of this really is to be, either it's a standalone or part of the overall, I call it, I'm totally lost.
Yeah, that's
now,
okay, because Henry,
there's a bigger vision.
Henry,
here.
You're doing a great job. And before I lose the camera, oh, he goes.
Communications is the word I was looking for. Our communication.
You're doing a great job in the department with it. I'm just saying, if we keep attracting people that are into the library end of it.
Right. No, and that's, I think.
What are we doing wrong?
Well, and we're seeing, you know, you're going to see the evolution of our information technology as part of the budget process. You're going to see, you know, this evolve over time. These things are changing because, you know, IT used to be about, you know, making that desktop work. You know, the field really now is about content management. You know, how do you handle the data? And it's a different process altogether. And so we're doing a lot of evolution here. And, you know, what that final product, you know, 3-5 years down the road is going to look like probably is not going to look like anything we have structurally today. So things will change.
Councilman Edgar.
I don't mean to make this go on any longer than it is, but the way it was advertised was 4 year people. Technically, the 2 year people should not have even been considered because they didn't meet the advertisement there. That was wrong to begin with. I'm not against changing it to 2 years. But what I am against and what I think that we should do is repost it and give everybody a chance to do it. Otherwise, what you've said now, you've already picked somebody. That person may come out ahead, but you're not giving all these other people a chance. And I'm still going to vote no unless we repost it.
Well, and you know, I guess maybe I just I don't necessarily like the, you know, the some of the terms you use there. I don't think it was wrong of us to think about what is the best for the organization and try to address that in a innovative and quick way. And I think that's if that is what the goal is, that we're going to be set in a box and we're going to live and operate within that box, we can do that. But I think, you know, expectations need to be refocused on what can get done. I mean, you know, we have over the last 5 years reduced staffing, we've reduced cost, we've reduced a lot here. And the reason that we've been able to do that is living within the rules that we have to be innovative and do things very quickly. And I guess that, again, you know, should be a good thing that we try to get our employees to do. You know, we haven't violated any laws. We haven't done anything unethical in this. You know, we've looked out for the best interest of the organization. Now we come to you to ask you to make a change that will allow us to address that in a very expeditious manner. You know, do I really, you know, I guess, you know, one of the things I was thinking about this is that, you know, those individuals that applied that didn't have 4 year, you know, that tells us something as well. I mean, that tells us something about how they're made up. I mean, you could say they're fools because, you know, we wouldn't, you know, look at their resumes because they didn't have 4 years, but also shows a boldness that they're willing to take that risk. And again, that's something that we should be trying to reward within our employees to take that risk. And so I understand what you're saying, and that's why if council tells me to put this back out, I will do it tomorrow. And we'll do everything we can to get this done as expeditiously as possible. I have no problem doing that. I don't know if that's necessary, to be honest, but if council wants me to do that, I will do that.
Anything else, Red?
I really don't want to argue with you, but it is a point that the council approved the job description at 4 years. I'm not against changing it. But I'm saying if we change it, it has to be reposted. You may have a dozen other people out there. You may have more qualified people come out there. You don't know that because you have not given them a chance.
Anything further? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Denny.
I'm going to abstain because I believe that we should reappoint it.
Councilman Edgar?
Against.
Councilman Hall?
Four.
Mayor Copen?
Four.
Deputy Mayor Lee?
Four.
Councilman Stokes?
Four.
Councilman Suzak?
Four.
Councilman Arnone?
Four.
Councilman Bosco?
Four.
Councilman Sakala?
Against.
We have 7 in favor, 2 against, and 1 abstention.
All right, that completes miscellaneous. Next item would be public communications. Anyone in the audience wishing to address the council?
How's the weather?
He wants us to get out of the parking lot so we can finish plowing.
Be careful, I just put salt down. It's, you know, just be careful as you walk out. Great.
Thank you, Doug. Yes.
It's his private stock.
Oh, that way you can afford the salt?
Heat down to only 58, so you got about 15 minutes where it gets real cold.
Motion to adjourn.
Any councilman communications?
Just real
Councilman Bosco. Just
Bosco?
Yeah. Matt, I'm going to say something I thought I'd never, ever say. What would it take to do a study or get some preliminary plans done for extending the bike path down Town Farm Road? Me being the advocate I was for all these,
me
being the advocate I was for all these years to try to stop it, I do see a lot of people using it, and you know, I hate to say it, but maybe if we get the plans drawn up, we can get some more government cheese. And finish it up and get the road fixed. Well, at least the worst part of it is Town Farm Road to Broadbrook, because the road is really bad.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
All roads lead to the creamery.
All roads lead to the creamery.
So, I mean, I'm thinking that, like I said, and I was an advocate against it. And, you know, we have the section of Town Farm Road from Abbey Road to Broadbrook Road, which continues where the dream of it going was. And at that point there, we can fix drainage problems up into the raffiest fields that we have. We can get the road fixed and give the people that much more room to walk, because no one uses it for bikes. I still get aggravated. You feel like running some of them over while they're on their Speedos. But, you know, we got a beautiful million-dollar bike path, and they ride their bike in the road. But I think that if we... Yeah, they got them, whatever, in bicycle pants.
Bosco on Speedos is kind of closed my
mind. So I'm thinking that if... like I said, I'm actually turning red here, and now you can see my face because it's all exposed. But
I don't know which. I mean, that must be on the eastern side of the bike trail, because I don't see Speedos on.
Well, I don't know. That's Speedos. You know them bicycle pants?
You have to have binoculars out of the top window of the house.
All right. Hot pants.
Joey, any
hot pants?
No, that's it.
Councilman Stokes?
Just quickly, first of all, I want to say we're going to name this the Bosco Bike Path to Nowhere. And then I just want to wish my wife a happy birthday this coming Thursday. So.
Happy birthday, Don. Happy birthday. Councilman Communications, I've got one thing, Matt. If you could look into a resident contacted me while at the meeting. They're in the Spruce Land Road area, neighborhood area up by the prisons. The neighbors are stating that there is a panther in that area. Can you really investigate?
Wow.
Now, whether it's a panther,
can you put on your meat suit and go check it out?
Coyote, a cougar. Yep.
Panther.
So
bobcat is what I meant.
That's what.
I have pictures of photos of one in my backyard a feet right.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool.
So if you could look into that, that would be appreciated. Anything else? Is there a motion to adjourn by Councilman Stokes, seconded by Deputy Mayor Lee? All those in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed, we are adjourned. Good night.
Merry